Antichrist Superstar was a much darker, serious, even threatening record. A lot of the fun, mayhem, and surreal silliness that was with Marilyn Manson, even up to the point of Sweet Dreams coming out, or Smells Like Children coming out, was pretty much gone, was pretty much swallowed up by the more threatening, darker thing that came from Antichrist Superstar. And that was like the biggest, most significant change in the band and the band's appeal. Because it was, you know, once you get darker and louder and scarier, you can't say, oh, I was just kidding.
The road to Antichrist Superstar was paved by Smells Like Children.
There are children here somewhere. I can smell them.
Smells Like Children was my idea of a children's record. It was seeing everything from a child's point of view. It was grand and ugly at times. Smells Like Children is almost a metaphor for me trying to hold on to my childhood. Smells Like Children is technically considered an EP, even though it is the length of an LP. In fact, a pretty long LP at that. It's 16 tracks long. So why is it not included in the official Marilyn Manson album canon? Because it's more of an odds and ends type of deal. It's not really a selection of original songs. It's actually mostly remixes from Portrait of an American Family, done in a more industrial sound, which, in my opinion, sounds very ugly and unappealing, and three cover songs and a few other stupid little things thrown in there just for fun. So it wouldn't really make sense to say, oh yeah, Marilyn Manson albums, Portrait of an American Family, Smells Like Children, Antichrist Superstar. It would be a little bit weird, so it's kind of in its own category. There's also this redneck acoustic reimagining of Cake and Sodomy, sung by a very weird tour bus driver named Tony Wiggins.
White trash, get down on your knees. It's time for Cake and Sodomy.
Calling Tony Wiggins weird is an understatement. 194 pounds of abused flesh, atrophied muscle, and hard bone, Tony Wiggins was a vacuum cleaner for sin. His blue eyes shone with the light of a perpetual party, and his cyanotic lips curled and uncurled in threatening invitation. Only his redneck charm, emanating from a blonde ponytail and Colonel Sanders' goatee, hinted at any semblance of manners, decency, or morality. No matter where he was, at what hour, the smaller the town and the more unlikely the circumstance, the better. Tony Wiggins managed to suck up the filth, corruption, and decadence off the streets and bring it back to us. And Tony Wiggins was also an inventor of sorts. Specifically, he invented a torture device where the victim is locked into this thing with a big rope around their neck, and they have to sit there in an awkward position unable to move, and if they relax at all, then the rope will tighten around their necks, choking them to death. He and Manson used this device on a lot of people, by the way. This was a used device, and they used it while they were on tour. They would get people who come in, weird people coming in backstage into this secret room, and they would put them in this torture device willingly, and then they would ask them a bunch of questions. They would interrogate them, basically, get them to reveal all of their personal secrets and confessions. And they got him to reveal some pretty dark stuff, some of which actually disturbed Manson a bit, and he didn't quite know how to feel about some of it. Because despite making himself into an icon of the kind of deranged side of America, he still felt like his fans had much crazier lives than he ever did. Audio extracted from this odd experimental abuse roleplay was originally going to be used on Smells Like Children, but they decided not to. I don't exactly know why, but I assume it's for confidentiality reasons, and so it wasn't included. But if it had been, it would have probably matched the overall theme of the record in more than one way.
It's got a bit of a theme running through it. It started off, of course, with Dope Hat, which was the single that we were focusing on, and dealing with the use and abuse that's talked about in that song, and then with Sweet Dreams, and there's a few other tracks. We were living in New Orleans at the time, and different subjects that played a big part in our lives for those 4 months, ranging from drugs to sex and whatever's in between. We just kind of wanted to express what we went through during that period, and this music is kind of a little diary of those 4 months. And it may seem kind of chaotic, but that's exactly how our lifestyles were, before we left on this tour.
It Smells Like Children acts as a diary of one of their tours. And if you think of it in that way, it makes a little bit more sense, because they were on these tours playing, or supposed to be playing, songs from Portrait of an American Family, and they would have been playing them in a more ugly and kind of rushed way. And so I guess the industrial remixes of these songs from Portrait of an American Family kind of capture a little bit of that horror. The fact that during our warm-up show in Nevada, some girl fed me crystal meth, telling me it was coke, didn't help any. I vomited through the entire show and couldn't sleep on the day-long bus ride to our first show with Danzig in San Francisco. I walked on stage that first night wearing a hospital smock from a mental ward, a black jock strap, and boots. My eyes were red and bleary from 3 sleepless nights. Right away, I felt something cold and hard hit my face. I thought it was the microphone, but it clattered to the floor and smashed, sending shards of glass splintering into my leg. It was a bottle from the audience. By our second song, there were bottles and refuse all over the stage, and a muscle-tattooed fraternity reject in the front row was challenging me to a fight. I was so enraged at this point that I grabbed a beer bottle off the stage, smashed it on the drum kit, and stopped the song. "If you want to fight me, come up on stage, you pussy," I screamed. Then I took the jagged half bottle and plunged it into the side of my chest, dragging it across my skin until it reached the other side and creating one of the deepest and biggest scars on the latticework that is my torso. Gushing blood, I dove into the crowd and landed on the frat head. When security threw me back on stage, I was completely naked, and nearly everybody in the front rows was stained with blood. I grabbed the microphone stand and sent it hurtling through Ginger's bass drum, destroying it. He looked up at me angry and confused, but quickly caught on, punching through his snare. Twiggy raised his bass over his head and brought it splintering down on the monitor. Daisy raised his axe and dropped it on his foot. We destroyed everything on stage short of each other. And that was a normal night for them.
Well, there's a lot of rumors that we set fire to our drummer and that we killed a chicken, but what actually happened was there was a night that we killed our drummer and then we had chicken for dinner. They get it mixed up every time.
You see how things get blown out of proportion?
We didn't want to be on stage playing music, so every night we didn't. The shows continued to be short exercises in brutality and nihilism, and the roadmap across my chest began to expand with scars, bruises, and welts. We had all become wretched, exhausted, empty containers. Westworld automatons gone berserk. Replacing the junkie on bass was another junkie, Twiggy Ramirez, who would go on to become an important musical collaborator for Manson on Antichrist Superstar and a few other works. But for now, he just kind of sat next to him on interviews like a sedated Yoko Ono.
Twiggy, hello. Would you say that you, Marilyn Manson, minds being a scapegoat? Is that of an issue to you?
Space ghost.
Scapegoat.
The Marilyn Manson tours of 1995 really sound like the kind of party where nobody is actually having a good time. But besides that, that period produced some of Manson's best performances. When he was willing to perform, that is. He was at his best and most fearsome when he was young, spry, and loaded with cocaine. Honestly, have you seen his recent performances? Cause they're kinda whack, yo. But anyway, a totally trashy experience. And so, of course, the diary of such experience is going to be trashy. Smells Like Children is really a trash album. There's nothing worthwhile on this from just an artistic standpoint. Now, the three cover songs are pretty good, but, you know, all the remixes of Portrait of an American Family. The point I'm getting at is that this album doesn't add anything new, lyrically or artistically, to Marilyn Manson. He doesn't have any new points to say, he's not developing his craft as a songwriter at all. That being said, those covers are pretty good covers. We got Rock and Roll Nigger by Patti Smith. I Put a Spell on You by Screamin' Jay Hawkins and Eurythmics' Sweet Dreams. Some of them want to abuse you. Portrait of an American Family went largely unnoticed on release. I think largely its little success was due to the fact that Trent Reznor's name was attached to it in some way, and possibly a bit of their Florida scene was into it as well. But really, it was Smells Like Children and the cover of Sweet Dreams, which was released as the single, which was their big hit, their first big hit. Now, of course, the label wanted to release I Put a Spell on You as the single. Because of mine. But Manson was adamant that no, it has to be Sweet Dreams, because Sweet Dreams was going to be the hit. And he was right. The music video for Sweet Dreams probably had a lot to do with the success of the song, and MTV would, of course, go on to be a very important collaborator and really, an ally for Marilyn Manson in the 90s and early 2000s. And of course, this music video was the first Manson video that really emphasized his freakishness. I mean, this is the first one where you might watch this and actually kind of get scared or a little bit perturbed by what you see. The concept was created by the video's director, Dean Carr, and it's basically just the band walking through some kind of abandoned insane asylum, and Manson dressing up in weird costumes and trying to make himself look kind of freaky. There's also this one part where he's riding a pig while caked in black body paint. I guess it's supposed to mean something related to abuse and exploitation, kind of like the themes of the song and the album, but honestly, it's just too comical to take seriously. But you can really tell that this aesthetic, it appealed to Manson, and so much that he actually hired the director to be the main photographer on Antichrist Superstar, and that's why you see really a continuity there in the style. And in fact, the music videos for Antichrist Superstar, which were directed by Floria Sigismondi, also very clearly take influence from Dean Carr's work. It seems like Manson gave her notes that, hey, I want you to emulate the style of Dean Carr. He probably also showed her the movie Begotten, which he also showed to Dean Carr, which was a film that was very important aesthetically for the kind of art that was on the record. And besides all that, the song is just so good. How could Manson disrespect this man? He was so brilliant. Although I did actually get around to listening to some of his other band, Three Ton Gate, and now sweet 16, after the success of Sweet Dreams, now, all of a sudden, people all over the country were eagerly awaiting the next Marilyn Manson release. Suddenly, Marilyn Manson was a bit of a household name, and people were paying attention and wondering, what's he gonna come out with next? And it was pretty obvious that whatever he was gonna put out next was going to be called Antichrist Superstar, because that was a name he was kind of hyping up all the way back in 1995. And even on Smells Like Children, he calls himself the All-American Antichrist. So clearly, he's really building up to this, as this is going to be a big deal. Now, if you're in 1995, what are you thinking when you hear Antichrist Superstar? Are you thinking that this is going to be some kind of goth parody of Jesus Christ Superstar? A play that was already kind of a parody of the Gospels anyway? To put it bluntly, no. Antichrist Superstar was going to be something much more important than that. It was to be Manson's personal statement to the world and a prophecy of the end times. But I don't think anyone except for Manson could be able to anticipate how impactful it would be. I've thought about being the Antichrist ever since the word was first taught to me at Christian school. In the Bible, the word Antichrist is only used as a description of people who don't believe in the teachings of Jesus of Nazareth. He is not described as one satanic entity, as the beast of Revelation, which many people believe, but as a person, any person, who deviates from the Christian orthodoxy. But through years of myth-making and fear-sowing, Christianity metamorphosed antichrists into a single antichrist, an apocalyptic villain and Christian boogeyman used to scare people, much as Santa Claus is used to regulate children's behavior. After years of studying the concept, I began to realize that the antichrist is a character, a metaphor, who exists in nearly all religions under different names, and maybe there is some truth in it, a need for such a person. But from another perspective, this person could be seen not as a villain, but as a final hero to save people from their own ignorance. The apocalypse doesn't have to be fire and brimstone. It can happen on a personal level. If you believe you're the center of your own universe and you want to see the universe destroyed, it only takes one bullet.
My beautiful people!
Thank you.
There's so many people these days that are so mad about this one book right here. So I think we should take a moment to read what it has to say. It says here that you gotta be saved in order to go to heaven. As I see it, you only gotta be yourself to go to hell. We will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity. And we will no longer be oppressed by the police state mentality. Sing with me. Shoot, 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 motherfucker. Shoot, 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 motherfucker.
The Antichrist Superstar for me was written to represent a transformation and an apocalypse. And for me, it became a personal apocalypse. So I pushed myself towards death, towards everything that I was thinking about. So I did assume the role of, you know, Antichrist to America.
Our new record, Antichrist Superstar, is a sort of autobiography. It looks at my own death. It looks at how things relate to society. And there is a struggle between if there's a hope and if there's no hope. And that's really where Antichrist Superstar is, the element of everybody's personality that's nihilistic and, you know, very gothic, and that has no, you know, trust for mankind. And that's a struggle that I go through daily, whether, you know, I think there's a reason to care or if there's no reason to care. So, I mean, that's one side of what I do. I think our new record is very, you know, balanced in that it looks at both sides.
I climbed into the cracked red leather seat of a metal barber's chair in the living room that served as a womb, protection from a studio that had become a nemesis and a city that had turned against me. I often imagined that it was a pilot's chair, gutted from a helicopter like the one my father flew in Vietnam. I closed my eyes and focused on my heart, beating triple time against my chest. I let the pulse, the rhythm, the warmth spread through me, then concentrated on lifting that enveloping warm essence out of the scarred, abused container of my body as I had read about in so many books on astral projection. I let myself be carried upwards, higher and higher into the night, until I was immersed in a radiant, consuming white. I felt myself growing, a body wrapping around me now, wings spreading from my back, ribs jutting through my skin like serrated knives, face deforming into the monster I knew I had become. I heard myself laugh an ugly, rebellious laugh, my mouth widening in a malevolent sneer large enough to engulf the spinning ball of earth below, a world of petty lives with petty problems and even pettier joys. I could swallow it if I wanted to, dispose of it once and for all. It's what they had been praying for. It's what I had been sinning for. "Pray now, motherfuckers," I heard myself bellow, the sound rattling the firmament. "Pray your life was just a dream." And the earth answered back with a loud, clattering scream that resounded so loudly in my head that I had to press my palms against my temples to keep my sanity or insanity. apocalypse has come to be associated with the end of the world. But in truth, the Greek word apocalypsis just means revelation, specifically the kind of dreamlike or hallucinatory vision received by a saint that tells them something about the past, present, or future through the medium of cryptic, symbolic, interpretive imagery. Now, this passage that I just read from The Long Hard Road Out of Hell can be interpreted as an apocalypse, and it is an apocalypse that shows Manson transforming from the worm into the Antichrist superstar, a figure of power and contempt for his fellow man. This daydream really symbolizes and evokes the core concepts of the album. This metamorphosis is very key. He removes his soul from his body, effectively shedding his old skin, his old ways of thinking, and becoming a new, fearsome, malevolent version of himself, which is ready to destroy the whole world. And just what world exactly he is devouring exists on multiple symbolic planes. On the most exoteric end of the scale, we have Manson destroying the physical Earth and its inhabitants as retribution for the years of being beaten down by the world, and as a punishment for a sick culture centered on authority and death. It's sort of like he's saying, if you can't beat him, join them by beating them. Antichrist Superstar is therefore a record about destruction, misanthropy, and payback, which gives it its very intense emotional charge. But on a level higher, it represents suicide. The destruction of the world is the destruction of Manson's own personal world. It's a personal apocalypse. In destroying the world, the Antichrist Superstar destroys himself, because he is, after all, a part of the world. I'm on my way out now. I'd like to take you with me. I'm on my way down. I'm on my way out now. I'd like to take you with me. I'm on my way down. This is the hopeless side of Manson expressing itself. Although it might not entirely be hopeless, because Manson does not really represent his death as a finality. In fact, the other half of this interpretation is that his metaphorical death is what brings him out of suicide, that in bringing himself closer to death and chaos in the making of this record, with all the cocaine, lack of sleep, unproductiveness, and all the betrayal he felt he experienced, he then pushes himself into these very dark places, and out of that, he's able to create a record which really breathes life into people, and breathed life into him in an interesting way, and kind of made him whole again. And we'll explore more about that concept on the next episode of Fundamentally Loathsome, but it's very interesting how this record changed Manson spiritually. Antichrist Superstar is therefore a record about finding a reason to live in the face of death. Let's jump up on the shop swords. Cut away our smiles without the threat of death. There's no reason to live at all. On another symbolic level higher than that, the end of the world represents the end of this world, the world of our forefathers, of Christian or fascist values, what Manson calls the fascism of beauty, and the rebirth of mankind under a new reign of individuality. When Manson calls himself the Antichrist, usually he's referring to it in this context as the harbinger of the destruction of this world in order to make way for a new, better world. It's the end of the age of Pisces and the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Antichrist Superstar is therefore a record about making way for a new world by ruthlessly destroying the old one. I'm really into the idea that the Antichrist Christianity has worried about for so many years is really man's unconscious disbelief in God. The Antichrist is a collective mindset of people who don't believe in God. I may be the person who awakens that idea in people. The thing that they're afraid of is themselves. But on the topmost plane of symbolism, the destruction of the world is a metaphor for the metamorphosis undergone by Manson. In purging the world, he is purging his own consciousness of all the guilt and resentment that he has acquired in his life as the worm. The wounded, broken man who couldn't take it anymore, and then somehow found the strength within himself to discover his wings and fly. The end of the world is therefore the end of Manson's world as he knew it, the end of the scared little boy, and the rebirth of him as a new towering anti-hero figure that he always wanted to be. Antichrist Superstar is therefore a record about personal empowerment and the triumph of the will. Making this record, I had in mind that it would be a musical ritual. When you play it, it brings you one step closer to the apocalypse. Not in a science fiction type way where a kid plays a record backwards and then a demon appears in his room, but in a way that is an Armageddon of the mind. Each time someone listens to Antichrist Superstar, it brings them closer to being an individual. For Christianity, that is the apocalypse. When I speak about the end of the world, it may be in literal terms, or it may be a matter of everything in your mind dying off and starting fresh. Manson allowed this piece to exist on multiple symbolic frequencies, which means that it is not a ham-fisted one-to-one allegory that you might suspect of a more base artist. Instead, it's really applicable to a lot of situations, which gives it its resonant power. In the metamorphosis of insects, there are three distinct phases. During the larval stage, they are worms. During the pupal stage, their bodies become encased in a hard outer coating as their insides liquefy and rearrange themselves. And then finally, with the inauguration of the third mature stage, the insects basically hatch from their pupa containers, almost like when they were born from their eggs. And so the third metamorphosis stage really can be seen as a kind of rebirth, which often is accompanied by the first time these insects spread their wings and fly, and the power of flight gives them the power to go wherever they want and do whatever they want. Insects and worms are a very dominant motif on Antichrist Superstar. They appear everywhere on the album, and for very good reason. Insects and other creepy crawlies are the most despised creatures on the planet, but not because they really deserve it. I mean, sure, they're savage, but so are most other animals, and people don't really complain about otters, for instance. The insect world isn't appreciated by us, not because of them, but because of us. Because we're mammals, and more to the point, we're vertebrates. There are many degrees of separation between us and the arthropod world, and we simply do not see eye to compound eye. Their appearances, which must be quite mundane to them, are nightmarish to us. Despite their small size, they have a power over us that we don't really acknowledge. A wasp no more than 2 centimeters long can strike fear in a grown man. I have a distinct memory of peering into a wasp trap once and seeing a yellow jacket aimlessly carrying around the head of one of its dead cellmates in its mandibles, and I remember just being struck by how different this creature was for me, and yet how similar. It's like its every move was a dark analog of a human being, a twisted parody of Homo sapiens, the way they crawl all over each other in these cramped and crowded hives without any concern for personal space, the way they devour their prey in such a cold and heartless way. And yet, the unease that I feel when I look at these creatures is more in how I perceive them than in the objective qualities of the creatures themselves. It's my own perception. Just as a human being could be something nightmarishly creepy to a creature of another planet. For that reason, insects and other creepy crawlies are the outcasts of the animal kingdom. Since man has conquered the world and the food chain, he is allowed to create God in his own image, and so therefore, he is allowed to decide what is beautiful and what is ugly. And so insects are treated with contempt because they are different, because they are hard to understand. And so as a motif, they work very well on this album because this is an album for the outcasts, for the people who don't feel they fit into society's arbitrary definition of beauty or virtue or whatever that thing is. The outcast might start out as a groveling worm, feeding on the decaying corpse and anatomy of a once perfect human being, hoping to somehow ingest that essence of what true beauty and virtue is, parasitically attaching themselves to their betters. But if they get hip and realize what's really going on, they'll discover their wings and fly. They'll embrace their true selves. And the true self is ugly. It is savage. In merely being a heterotroph, you must pulverize the remains of other living things. All life is predicated on violence. So, of course, you are not going to find this violence, which is inherent in the system, absent from your own mind. The ugly, unflattered human being must learn to disregard and mock other people's oppressive notions of beauty in order to embrace his true self. He has to create for himself a morality that's not about abstaining, that's not about saying, oh no, I can't do this, it's wrong, but about doing and becoming, a morality about vitality. A morality that says, if I don't try this, it will be worse than if I fail. It's a morality that is self-determined and unbound to the objections of weaker minds. This character, pictured on the front cover of the album, is called the Worm, and he is a creature of contempt. I use the metaphor of a worm to represent the more vulnerable period of growing up and the transformation into this more realized winged metaphor of an angel, much like the caterpillar into a butterfly, but that not being the final process. Antichrist Superstar is the third and final cycle that really devours everything before it. The Worm has a lot of references to different things in literature, from Darwin's idea of man as a worm, to Milton's The Undying Worm, to revelations in the Bible. I always looked at the Worm as something that people underestimate, but has more power than they expect it to. The look of Manson as the Worm is taken from this character from Begotten called Son of Earth, who is a newborn, fully grown man covered in dirt, just kind of flailing around in the mud, completely helpless. You can tell that this image really struck a chord with Manson because he not only uses it on this album, but later on Hollywood, a music video called The Nobodies, he is also depicting himself as this Son of Earth character. The Worm represents the feeling of being discarded or oppressed and the resentment that results from that. It's a mindset driven by a lot of fear and doubt, and wanting to fit in, but being unable to fit in, and not being able to quite accept that you can't fit in. And the Worm has to reach his lowest point before he can realize that his true self doesn't fit in, that his true self is anti-establishment. It is Antichrist. On the front cover, if you look closely, you can see insect wings sprouting from his back. And so this moment represents the moment where the worm transforms into the angel with the scabbed wings. His final form as the Antichrist appears on the back cover of the album, and here he is dressed in a black and red suit, which is the same costume he used to wear during his performances of the title track. This was always a big set piece of his concerts, where he represented a combination of a rock star, a politician, and a televangelist, delivering this sermon on top of his massive podium while ripping pages out of a Bible, while electric shock symbols representing his shocking message and his power adorned the walls behind him, draped in the form of immense fascist flags, while his goons accompanied him on their musical instruments. Antichrist Superstar is a figure of power, and he acquires this power by inspiring people to rally behind him with his anti-establishment message.
My fellow Americans, we will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity, and we will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of beauty, because I see you all sitting out there trying your hardest not to be ugly. Trying your hardest not to fit in, trying your hardest to earn your way into heaven. But let me ask you, do you want to be in a place that's filled with a bunch of assholes?
In a world run by what Manson calls the beautiful people, where beauty and virtue are arbitrated by a fascist elite, the Antichrist Superstar stands in mockery of that establishment and proclaims himself arrogantly to be his own god. All beings have so far created something beyond themselves. And do you want to be the ebb of this great flood and even go back to the beasts rather than overcome man? What is the ape to man? A laughing stock or a painful embarrassment? And man shall be just that for the Superman, a laughing stock or a painful embarrassment. You have made your way from worm to man, and much in you is still worm. Once you were apes, and even now too, man is more ape than any ape. To truly understand the Antichrist Superstar, I deem it pertinent to look at the plain old ordinary Antichrist. As it was explained to Manson in Christian school, the Antichrist was a false prophet that would appear at the dawn of the end times and commence the second coming of Jesus Christ by leading a bunch of people away from God. It's a concept that's gone through a lot of evolution over the years, but its rudimentary sources go back to the days of Jesus himself, who in Mark chapter 13 and Matthew chapter 24 used a term, an Aramaic term, which has been translated in Greek as pseudo-Christ, to describe a certain type of person. These chapters describe the same event in pretty much the same way. Jesus and his followers are coming out of the temple one day, and they are marked upon the beautiful buildings in the area. These beautiful stones, and Jesus says, you know, one day all of these buildings will be toppled and not one stone will be left on top of another. And so his followers say, can you tell us any portents of that day?
in anticipation of his return. And Jesus gives them a big warning. He basically says, beware of bad news in the end times. Before my second coming, there'll be war and rumors of war and famine and earthquakes, and the sun will go dark and the moon will cease giving light and the stars will fall from the sky. And in reaction to all this, there will be many false prophets or pseudo-Christs who will try to lead you astray. But don't listen to any of them, because when I do return, you'll definitely know. The moral of the story is to be vigilant and not to listen to any false prophets when times are looking dire. Marilyn Manson could be seen as one such false prophet. In the changing social landscape of the 1990s, many people were feeling lost and disillusioned by Christianity, and then here comes this guy saying, hey you! You can be your own God. You don't have to listen to any of these fools. So Jesus uses the word pseudo-Christ, but he doesn't use the word antichrist. That word first appears when it's used by John, who writes about antichrists as people who deny the divinity of Jesus. They are antichrist. This is also the meaning of the word as it was used by Friedrich Nietzsche, who wrote a whole book at the end of his career called The Antichrist, which was about his dislike of Christianity. And objecting to it not through the lens of positivism, but more through a moral and ethical lens, in very much the same manner as Manson. The next apostle on the list is Paul, and he doesn't use the word antichrist, but he describes something that is very, very similar to what Jesus said in those chapters that we talked about earlier. In his second epistle to the Thessalonians, he warns them about all of these false prophets and pamphlets going around that are claiming to be written by the apostles or even by Jesus himself, many of them claiming that the end times were already coming or that Jesus has already returned, so on. And Paul says that the reason he's certain that all of these are fake is because the end times and the coming of Jesus won't happen until the lawless one arrives, or is revealed, rather. The lawless one is a false prophet who commits the ultimate act of apostasy. He denies all gods or objects of worship. He sits in the very temple of God, claiming to be God, and he does it with the adulation of many fans. Only after this calamitous act of apostasy will Jesus return and then destroy the lawless one personally with his own breath, which I interpret to mean words, but it could also be a fire-breathing Jesus. And that might be a way cooler interpretation. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the lawless one is revealed, the one destined for destruction. He opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, declaring himself to be God. The lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will destroy with the breath of his mouth, annihilating him by the manifestation of his coming. But this lawless one is sent to earth by God, apparently, in order to weed out the apostates, to make sure that only those who are truly worthy of God's love will receive it. He's thinning the herd. He will lead all of the corrupt away, so they can be purged from the world along with him, their souls presumably thrown into the lake of fire and destroyed. I don't think the lake of fire was meant to be an eternal punishment back then, but I could be wrong. But the point I'm getting at is that the lawless one is not an agent of destruction, he is merely the harbinger of it, and himself a victim of it. And all of his dirty, rotten fans are also victims of it. The coming of the lawless one is apparent in the working of Satan, who uses all power, signs, lying wonders, and every kind of wicked deception for those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion, leading them to believe what is false, so that all who have not believed the truth, but took pleasure in unrighteousness, will be condemned. The lawless one is therefore an agent of God in a roundabout way. The very man who opposed God and tried to replace him is actually working perfectly into his plan, which means they're kind of not really enemies at all. They're kind of best buds, if you think about it. Frenemies. It's like the alliance between Santa Claus and Krampus. Punishment for the wicked children, and gifts for the good. Good cop, bad cop. And I do believe Manson has considered the Antichrist from this perspective. He was very fond of quoting the part in the Satanic Bible where it says the devil has been the best friend the church has ever had because it's kept it in business all these many years. So even though Manson is attempting to destroy the church, he's actually making it ever more vigilant in challenging it. The Antichrist might not have existed before the time of Jesus, but the roots of the concept of the Antichrist go all the way back to the book of Daniel. Yeah, they really go back that far. Stories about Daniel and his fellow Jewish wise men in the Babylonian court were very popular among Jews both during and after the period of Babylonian captivity. These stories were popular because they showed the Jewish God triumphing over the gods of the Babylonians by protecting his pious believers from the Babylonian aggressions against their religion. For instance, there's a story about Daniel's friends being thrown into a big incinerator because they refused to worship a golden statue of King Nebuchadnezzar, but then they come out of the incinerator completely unharmed. There's another story about Daniel himself being thrown into a den of lions, and again, he comes out completely unharmed. And it always shows the king of Babylon just being so wowed and amazed by the God of the Jews and wanting to supplicate to him at the end of the story instead of the god of his nation, which I guess would be Marduk back then. And the Babylonian captivity, what this was when Babylon conquered Israel and Judea. I don't know if they were two separate countries at this point or not. They conquered one of them. They actually destroyed the first temple of Jerusalem, which was built by King Solomon himself in the 10th century, I believe, and this was in the 6th century. And then they took like thousands of these very important Jewish leaders, took them away to Babylon, and just kept them there for 70 years. I think some of them actually were old enough by the end of it to remember being taken to Babylon and then were able to come back after the period of exile. And the destruction of the Jewish temple was extremely traumatic, of course, because the temple was pretty much the main focus of their religion back then. This is before the diaspora. Really, this is, I guess, kind of the start of the whole Jewish diaspora phenomenon, where they're taken away from their homeland, and because of that, there's this kind of feeling of a rift or an incompleteness in the Jewish identity, which I guess Zionists wanted to remedy, but Zionists aren't very popular among a lot of Orthodox Jews for reasons that we're not going to get into right now. So yeah, the word Babylon lived in a lot of infamy for the Jews, and it wasn't uncommon for another country that they disliked to be given the designation of Babylon as basically an insult or a statement that history is repeating itself. And the authors of the Book of Daniel, who are living in a time period pretty far removed from the time when Daniel was supposed to have lived, they were living well beyond the Babylonian captivity, more around the 2nd century BC. And that was during the time of the Maccabee Revolt. And so they had a new Babylon, kind of. And their Babylon was the Seleucid Kingdom, ruled by Antiochus IV Epiphanes, who was a very nasty king who the Jews very much disliked. In fact, and I'm just gonna say it, Antiochus IV Epiphanes is the Antichrist. Sort of. The Jews liked Antiochus IV Epiphanes about as much as they liked Hitler. The second half of the Book of Daniel is basically a big screed against him, but they were clever not to mention him by name. But they did leave us a lot of clues, And if you know their history, these clues are pretty straightforward. So the reason the animosity between these two started is because Antiochus IV was a Greek. And as such, he was very proud of his culture and wanted to basically force it into his whole kingdom, where a lot of people felt it didn't belong, Greekifying the kingdom. The Jews had a complicated relationship with this sort of practice. Through all of Jewish history, there have been a lot of them who were pretty much okay with it, didn't really have a problem with the importation of Hellenistic culture, Hellenistic ideas, philosophy, art, fashion, etc. But there were those people, the hardliners, in every generation. In this generation, it happened to be the Hasideans. But the clincher is that Antiochus, being king, was able to choose the high priest of the temple. And the guy who they had in was named Jason. Antiochus didn't like him, so he got rid of him, replaced him with a guy called Menelaus. But then Jason, turns out, didn't actually stand for that. And he gathered a bunch of Hasideans together, and they all retook Jerusalem from the Greeks. Antiochus was so mad at that he outlawed the practice of the Jewish religion, and he desecrated the temple. Didn't destroy it this time, but he destroyed the altar and replaced it with an altar for Zeus, which is an insult not quite as bad as the Babylonians, but in the same ballpark. The result of all of this was the revolt of the famous Judah Maccabee, which became the holiday known as Hanukkah. And so every year when the Jews light them menorahs, they're thinking about how much they hate Antiochus IV Epiphanes, the Antichrist. But the connection between this guy and the Antichrist comes from the second half of Daniel, which was the apocalypses of Daniel, his revelations, his visions that he received from God showing him cryptic images, which are not so cryptic. If you're woke, if you're in the know, it makes sense that the writers during the time of the Maccabee rebellion would have been thinking back to the Babylonian captivity, thinking back to the stories of Daniel, and maybe that's where the connection between these two stories lies. In chapter 7, Daniel has a dream where he sees the four winds stirring up the ocean, and then four beasts rising out of it. And his servant, in interpreting the dream, tells him that these four beasts represent four kingdoms. It's left up to our imaginations to interpret which kingdoms these beasts represent. But the Oxford Annotated Bible has concluded that the first beast is Babylon, second beast is Media, the third one is Achaemenid Persia, and the fourth one is Alexander the Great and his successor kingdom in Asia, which was called the Seleucid Empire. Now, this is not the only interpretation that it could be, but whatever those previous three kingdoms are, specifically the two in the middle, the last one is pretty obviously supposed to be Alexander. After this, I saw in the visions by night a fourth beast, terrifying and dreadful and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth and was devouring, breaking in pieces and stamping what was left with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that had preceded it, and it had 10 horns. I was considering the horns when another horn appeared, a little one coming up among them. To make room for it, three of the earlier horns were plucked up by the roots. There were eyes like human eyes in this horn, and a mouth speaking arrogantly. I watched then because of the noise of the arrogant words that the horn was speaking, and as I watched, the beast was put to death and its body destroyed and given over to be burned with fire. When Daniel asks his servant to interpret this dream, he takes special care to emphasize that fourth beast, and the servant says, "As for the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom on earth that shall be different from all the other kingdoms. It shall devour the whole earth and trample it down and break it into pieces. As for the 10 horns, out of this kingdom 10 kings shall arise, and another shall arise after them. This one shall be different from the former ones, and shall put down three kings. He shall speak words against the Most High, shall wear out the holy ones of the Most High, and shall attempt to change the sacred seasons and the law. And they shall be given into his power for a time, two times, and a half time. Then the court shall sit in judgment, and his dominion shall be taken away to be consumed and totally destroyed.
I just realized while editing this that if you consider a time to be 1 year, then one time plus two times plus half a time equals 42 months, which is a time span that will become more important when we discuss Revelation later on.
A kingdom that devoured the whole earth. Sounds a lot like Alexander the Great. After all, he conquered so much territory in such a quick amount of time that it might have seemed like he was conquering the whole earth. The little horn is Antiochus IV Epiphanes, and the three kings he displaces are the three kings who were displaced in the advent of Antiochus's reign, although in actual fact, Antiochus is probably only responsible for the death of Antiochus the Younger, his five-year-old nephew, who was also king at the same time as him. The little horn, with a rather comical description of having eyes in the mouth as if he's a character from The Annoying Orange. This little horn is arrogant and blasphemous and speaks words against God. And so the author of this apocalypse probably believed that God would render a judgment against the Seleucid kingdom and destroy it one day. And in so doing, he would bring about a rejuvenation of the kingdom of Jerusalem on earth. Although, I think that he might have thought of it as being a rather soon phenomenon, because he was writing during the Judah Maccabee revolt. So it's possible that he believed that this revolt would bring about that great victory of Israel once more, and that this kingdom would continue to conquer the world, if not literally, then spiritually. And this interpretation of the apocalypse is reinforced by other apocalypses in the book, which all are about the same thing and expressed in different ways, but through putting all the pieces together, it's very clear that this is who he's talking about. It's very easy to see how the lawless one and the little horn, or the fourth beast of Daniel, could be connected. They're both arrogant, blasphemous people who are smote by God, announcing some sort of a revival. In the case of Thessalonians, it was talking about the second coming. In the case of this, it's talking more about a reestablishment of the Jews as a political and spiritual power. Manson therefore references the little horn on Antichrist Superstar because it's an example of an Antichrist-like figure. The one other big apocalypse that talks about the Antichrist is, of course, the Book of Revelation, the final book in the New Testament. And it was written by a guy named John, who went to the island, the Greek island of Patmos, one time and received this amazing vision from God, which he then wrote down and sent as an epistle to the seven major churches of Asia Minor. Revelation takes a lot from the Old Testament, not just from the book of Daniel. It has references to Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, a bunch of other books I haven't read. Next to the Gospels and the Torah, it's probably the most iconic book in the Bible because there's just so many of these apocalyptic images that are so famous now because of this book. Like, the one that I love is the locusts with human faces and iron scales. There's also, of course, the four horsemen of the apocalypse and the seven angels blowing the seven trumpets, the lamb breaking the seventh seal. The list just keeps going and going of all these crazy metal images that come out of this book. And it's really a beautiful read. I mean, if you want something just abstract and interpretive and frankly insane, I would definitely recommend Revelation. And of course, it's this is the reason why the term apocalypse has come to mean the end of the world. It's because this apocalypse of John is about the end of the world. or at least the end of this world. In a move that was undoubtedly influenced by the Book of Daniel, John writes about various beasts which he sees emerging from the water or the land. The first time we see a beast, it shows up in chapter 11 when these two emissaries arrive in Jerusalem, which are called witnesses. After Jerusalem has been trampled on by the Gentile nations for 42 months, these two witnesses of God appear, prophets in the city dressed in sackcloth, basically just being moral busybodies and telling people to worship God. And these people are so annoying that you might be tempted to attack them physically, but if you try, then they'll breathe fire at you, so it's probably not a good idea. Also, they can stop the rain from coming down and they can turn the rivers to blood, just like Elijah and Moses did. So these people are quite powerful. But then the Savior arrives. Out of the bottomless pit comes the beast. The beast kills the two witnesses, and everyone is so relieved. Those prophets sure were annoying. But wait, after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet. And those who saw them were terrified. They then heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, "Come up here." And they went up to heaven in a cloud while their enemies watched them. At that moment, there was a great earthquake and a tenth of the city fell. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake and the rest were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. So yeah, very Antichrist-like story. We have these two people spreading the word of God and then this thing comes along and leads people away from it and acts all cool and above it all and arrogant. And, well, in this case, he's basically just committing an act of violence, but, you know, the same idea. The people think this beast is cool because he killed the lame prophets, but then, oh no, turns out that was the wrong idea, and the people who all supported and cheered for this beast die. In chapter 12, there's another beast, not really a beast, but a serpent. The red dragon, which is called Satan. Satan is the great adversary in the Bible. His name comes from a Hebrew word that means a critic or adversary or opponent or accuser. Now I could talk on and on and on about Satan, but it's not really all that important to this discussion. But what is kind of important about Satan is that he has this name connected to him that's pretty famous. It's Lucifer. And Lucifer is a name that's always applied to Satan when this idea, this legend about Satan is talked about, wherein he was an angel at one point who fell from grace, literally fell from heaven, and was basically kicked out and became resentful. He defied God and then was punished. I've always liked to make the point to people that the character of Lucifer, maybe if we were to have read the story from his point of view, he wouldn't have been the bad guy. So I like to show people, yeah, I am the bad guy, but at the same time, is that so bad after all? Now the Jews don't really have a concept of Satan, and Orthodox Jews don't really accept that Satan is a thing. They certainly don't have a concept of a fallen angel, but the origin of the Lucifer myth actually does come from the Old Testament, again, just like with the Antichrist. In the Latin translation of Isaiah, there's a part where Isaiah is condemning the king of Babylon, and he calls him Luciferus, which means light bringer. In the King James Version, this was translated into English by not translating it and just cutting off the grammatical ending, making it Lucifer. However, when they finally got around to doing the New Revised Standard Version, which is the version that I use for most purposes, they decided to actually, you know, translate the name, and it became Star of Morning, Son of the Dawn. And this is because the word Lucifer doesn't mean Satan. It means Venus, the planet Venus, which was also called the morning star when it's in the morning, and the evening star when it's in the evening. B, because Venus disappears in the morning sky before it can reach its highest point, because the daylight prevents you from seeing the stars, and then when the evening comes, you can see it descending again. And so it was connected to this Canaanite or Middle Eastern legend about somebody rising up against the gods, attempting to usurp God, and then being taken down for it. So the morning star, Venus, Lucifer, was a popular legend in the Middle East in ancient times, because the star never gets to the highest point. It comes up, and then it comes down. Venus is the brightest object in the sky at dawn, and so this idea of a bright, shining angel who was arrogant and then was cast down for it, you can see where these two legends connect. And so in calling the king of Babylon Lucifer, Isaiah was making an allusion to this legend, saying, "Maggots are spread out as your bed beneath you, and worms are your covering. How you have fallen from heaven, you star of morning, son of the dawn. You have been cut down to earth, you who defeated the nations. But you said in your heart, 'I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God, and I will sit on the mount of assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High.' Nevertheless, you will be brought down to Hades, to the recesses of the pit." Seeing it told like this by Isaiah makes it very clear that Lucifer is a quite similar character to the Antichrist. He's somebody who is arrogant, trying to usurp God, and then gets thrown down. So it's for this reason that Manson not only identifies as the Antichrist, but also identifies himself with Lucifer. There's a few other Bible quotes that can connect Lucifer to Satan, possibly. We see in Luke chapter 10, Jesus says, "I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning." All right, this might also be why Manson used the shock symbol as his icon, because this not only looks like a bolt of lightning or a burst of electricity, it also has an implied downward motion. I realized kind of at the last minute of making this video that I had forgotten to really write a whole lot about the occult significance of a lot of the iconography and such on Antichrist Superstar. It's an important element of the album. I don't know exactly how central it is, mostly because I just couldn't really be bothered to dig all that deep into the occult rituals and such that inspired Manson. But I do think it's important to analyze a little bit of the occult origin of the shock symbol that is used on the iconography of Antichrist Superstar, because I have already mentioned the sort of Luciferian connection there, and I've mentioned that, you know, the shock symbol represents shock rock, or the shocking message of his ideas. But there's also a deeper occult significance of it, and you can find that in this book, which Manson used to read while he was making Antichrist Superstar, called The Tetragrammaton: The Secret to Evoking Angelic Powers and the Key to the Apocalypse. So the central theory is that the name of God, which is represented with the Hebrew letters we see here, Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh, it's pronounced Yahweh usually in scholarly discourse, but in English traditionally it's pronounced Jehovah. It's basically the most magical word in existence, to the point where the entire cosmos can be seen as basically a refraction of the symbol of God's name. And so one of the things you can do is, if you make a diagram of the name of God with each letter on a compass point of a circle, then you can create these sigil banners, which can be used to either invoke or to banish certain angels. So if we notice here, there we go. If we notice here, the shock symbol of Antichrist Superstar is also the banishing
form of the angel Kazahel, who is an angel of mercy. And it is also the invoking form of Hezekiah, who is an angel of severity. And I found this little paragraph under here very interesting about the function of Hezekiah. It says, function to expose lies, to strike to the heart of issues, to reveal deception and pretense in all intellectual manners, to bring down false prophets, stop mail and communications fraud, to punish falsehoods in media and advertising. So in invoking Hezekiah in Manson's iconography on this record, we can see that he is kind of playing that same function of Hezekiah. And we can see on the CD jewel case, if you look very closely, you can see the tetragrammaton written in the four corners of the case. And if we take the CD with the sigil out of the case, we can see this diagram, which is called the Vivitruvian Antichrist. I'm not quite sure what the significance of that is other than to look cool, but there's so much interesting iconography in Marilyn Manson's music. You know, it's not just music, it's everything. It's the album art, it's the music videos. Everything has a purpose, and that's really what makes Marilyn Manson's stuff so exceptional.
But if you want more evidence that Satan is Lucifer, well, we can look back at Revelation number 12 and see that red beast, that red dragon that I was talking about earlier. Then another portent appeared in heaven, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his heads. The 7 heads make this serpent very reminiscent of the Greek Hydra, which grows 2 new heads every time you cut one off. In calling himself the Hydra, Manson gives the impression that he is immortal, but not invincible. That his head will grow back, but a scarred version of itself. The next verses in Revelation describe a war in heaven between the forces of the Red Dragon and the angels, led by the Archangel Michael. And it's this passage that explicitly connects Satan to Lucifer. Well, not explicitly, but implicitly. The great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to earth, and the angels were thrown down with him. Another term for the Antichrist superstar on this album is the angel with the scabbed wings. That, of course, comes from this idea of Lucifer. There's some more stuff about Lucifer in Ezekiel, where he's talking about the king of Tyre, but it's not worth going into right now. But from another perspective, Lucifer doesn't just resemble the Antichrist, this harbinger of the end times. It could also represent the origin story of this character of the worm, somebody who was at once maybe fit in with society or wanted to fit in with society, and then when he found that he couldn't, he rebelled and then was cast out, after which he becomes lonely and resentful of the people who rejected him and bent on their destruction. After describing the red dragon, John describes a great beast coming out of the sea. And I saw a beast rising out of the sea, having 10 horns and 7 heads, and on its horns were 10 diadems, and on its heads were blasphemous names. And the beast that I saw was like a leopard, its feet were a bear's, its mouth was like a lion's mouth, and the dragon gave it its power and his throne and great authority. One of its heads seemed to have received a death blow, but its mortal wound had been healed. In amazement, the whole earth followed the beast. They worshipped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast, and who can fight against it?" The beast was given a mouth, uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. It opens its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. Also, it was allowed to make war on the saints and to conquer them. It was given authority over every tribe and the people and language and nation. And all the inhabitants of the earth will worship it, everyone whose name has not been written from the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb that was slaughtered.
Uh-oh, Calvinism alert.
Let anyone who has an ear listen. If you are to be taken captive, into captivity you will go. If you kill with the sword you must be killed. Here is a call for the endurance and the faith of the saints. Bunch of interesting things here. You'll notice the beast is allowed to utter blasphemous words for 42 months, which was the same amount of time that the Gentile nations were ruling over Jerusalem in that previous passage before the two witnesses arrived, which indicates, I think, that these are two stories that tell a parable describing the same idea.
And if you'll recall in Daniel, it says that the sacred seasons and the law will be given over to the power of the little horn for 42 months, one time, two times, and a half time.
The three creatures that comprise the beast's features, the lion, the leopard, and the bear, are the very same creatures that appear in Daniel chapter 7. The first beast was like a lion, the second beast was a bear, the third beast was a leopard, and the fourth beast we don't really know what it was. So maybe John, the author of Revelation, was attempting to depict this fourth beast of Daniel in his Revelation, and so he used all of the features of the preceding beasts and then combined them together into this one amalgam. Like, the worst features of all of these previous empires here come again. But in Daniel, the fourth beast represented the Seleucid kingdom and Alexander the Great. So what exactly did the fourth beast represent to John of Patmos? Well, in the first century CE, AD, whichever you want to say, during the reign of Domitian, when John of Patmos was writing his revelation, which empire was on top of the world during that time? I believe I answered my own question. Domitian was the emperor of Rome. The heathen emperor of Rome. And early Christians would have had a lot of legitimate reason to dislike Rome. I mean, like 10 years after Emperor Titus, well, I don't think he was emperor at that point, but when Titus destroyed the second temple, yeah, the first one was destroyed by the Babylonians, the second one was destroyed by the Romans, so yeah, if anyone deserves to be called the second Babylon, it's Rome. There have been various attempts to build a third temple since then, but obviously none of them have really panned out. These days, the place where the temple used to be is now a mosque, so... But not only that, before that, maybe like 15 years before the destruction of the second temple, there was a great fire in the city of Rome, and the guy who was in charge at that time was named Nero. And one of the things he did was he basically just scapegoated the entire Christian population of the city for starting the fire when they had probably nothing to do with it. It's the same kind of thing that Christians used to do to Jews during the Middle Ages. And as a result, the Christian community in Rome was persecuted. Many of them were crucified, including Saint Peter himself, the first pope, who insisted that he be crucified upside down because he didn't think that he was worthy of being killed in the same manner as his buddy Jesus. But of course, then the St. Peter's cross took on a life of its own recently. So yeah, John calls Rome the Whore of Babylon, which is an insult for the ages. Not even Babylon, but the Whore of Babylon. And that comes from a metaphor that is used all throughout Revelation, where fornication is used as shorthand for worshiping other gods or other idols. And as for the mortal wound on one of the beast's heads that was miraculously not mortal, the Oxford Annotated Bible says could be a reference to Julius Caesar, how the assassination of Julius Caesar was meant to kill the dictatorship, but it only ended up empowering his nephew Octavian to revive it. Oxford also says that this could be a reference to the legend of Nero Redivivus, which was this idea that Nero will or has already returned in the flesh after death. After his own suicide, specifically. I don't know why people believe this. Maybe there were some diehard Nero supporters who were sad that he had to kill himself. But it was a rumor floating around back then, so it might have made it into this book. And this interpretation of the beast is held by the preterist theologians. But of course, the Protestant historicist theologians think the beast is supposed to be the Catholic Church. Gee, I wonder why. Then I saw another beast that rose out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast on its behalf, and it makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose mortal wound had been healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in the sight of all. And by the signs that it is allowed to perform on behalf of the beast, it deceives the inhabitants of earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that had been wounded by the sword and yet lived. And it was allowed to give breath to that image of the beast, so that the image of the beast could even speak and cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. This last part really sounds like it's referencing some sort of idol worship that was inflicted on people who didn't want to worship either Roman gods or Roman emperors. There were cults of actual Roman emperors. And one of the things that I know happened later, I don't think it happened during this period, but during the reign of Emperor Julian, there was a big thing where Julian was trying to bring paganism back. And he did make people swear allegiance to him, which a lot of Christians thought was against their religion, although that's kind of like, is it? They didn't want to swear allegiance to anyone except God, but I guess for political reasons they had to, and many chose to be martyred rather than go through that, which I think is kind of stupid, but Islam didn't have that problem, I don't think. Specifically Sunni Islam, I think in that religion you're supposed to just go with the program, because honestly, it doesn't matter what you say. What matters is what you actually believe. But anyway, this passage that I just read describes another beast. So we have the beast which represents the Roman Empire, and then we have this other beast which has two horns like a lamb. I interpret that to mean it looks like a lamb, but it speaks like a dragon. So we can see Revelation, the symbol of the lamb, represents Jesus. The dragon represents Satan. It's making itself appear to be Jesus or a prophet of some sort, but it's actually doing the work of the devil. It is a satanic inversion of Jesus Christ. You may call it an antichrist, or you may call it the Imperial Roman cult. Because after the death of Julius Caesar, Augustus convinced the Senate to make him a god, because apparently they have the power to do that. And ever since then, various emperors have been deified. Not all of them. Some of them may have even considered themselves deified when they were still alive. I know that Commodus believed himself to be Hercules. And this lamb who spoke like a dragon had the power to kill anyone who wouldn't worship the beast. And made this idol of the beast, gave it the power to kill anyone which wouldn't worship it. This obviously is a reference to martyrdom. Also, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell who does not have the mark, that is, the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. Let anyone with understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a person. Its number is 666. Great understanding in this context likely refers to the Hebrew practice of gematria, or gematria. It was a form of numerology, really a form of ciphering, or deciphering, because it would allow you to get the name of the beast if you could decipher the number of the beast. Several attempts to use this gematria practice on 666 have been made, and many people have settled on the idea that it deciphers into Neron Kaiser. And if this is true, it lends more credibility to the theory that the mortal wound on one of the heads of the beast, the other beast, is Nero's suicide and resurrection. Although I will point out that this theory is not without its opponents. And the mark of the beast here represents the most specific portent of the end times, which is economic repression. And now the modern advances in commercial technology have made it possible for little numbers to handle commercial transactions all on their own. So we get UPC codes and contactless payment and credit card numbers, etc. So these days there are a lot of numbers and numerical markings associated with commerce, and there's even now talks of a future where everything is paid by a microchip implanted in your hand. This has obviously led a lot of Christians back to this passage, worrying about whether this rumored microchip implant future is actually the mark of the beast. Although, if you think about it, it wouldn't really make a lot of sense to put it on your forehead, so I think maybe they're safe from this one. I mean, the forehead is explicitly mentioned as one of the spots for the mark of the beast. So, what, are they expecting people to get 666 implants in their forehead? Like, what? What I'm saying is there must be some clue here that we're missing. Some clue that we're missing. Oh yeah. Phylacteries. What's that? You've never heard of a phylactery? Well, that's probably because you're more familiar with the more common term, Tefillin. No, not Teflon, Tefillin. Tefillin are little boxes containing words from the Torah which are worn on the arms and on the foreheads of a lot of Jews. I mean, keep in mind that the Christians back then were pretty much just Jews with a slightly different outlook on the future, so it makes sense that the mark of the beast would be done up in imitation of a common form of worship. It would be, something which is presenting itself as pious and religious, but is actually a false deception. The Antichrist, disguising himself as the real Christ, will convince a bunch of people to wear these phylacteries, but instead of having Torah passages, they will instead have his name, the number of his name, or maybe the number of his name will be encoded in those passages somehow. And anyone who didn't wear these phylacteries would then be basically excommunicated from all commerce. You wouldn't be allowed to trade with these people, which really then increases the impetus to conform and adopt to this new way. And that makes it all the more scary for people coming up against the end times when they see this economic repression starting, or what they think could be this economic repression. How do you deal with that? Do you just not buy anything? Or do you just, you know, patiently wait for the second coming? Hopefully the rapture will take me before any of that happens. Also, the rapture, like, I don't even think the rapture is in Revelation at all. I mean, there's references to Jesus' followers, his saints, being saved from the destruction. But there's nothing like in The Thief in the Night where people just disappear. I'm not really sure how important it was to go into detail about the biblical origins of the Antichrist legend in a video that is supposed to be about Marilyn Manson's Antichrist Superstar, but, you know, I was working on this, I was doing so much research, and I found it all so interesting, but I couldn't figure out a way to separate it from this piece, because I've just, you know, I found so much that connected these things to the themes of Antichrist Superstar, and so I ended up just having to insert it into here. I was originally going to do two episodes about Antichrist Superstar, but that plan just didn't pan out properly, and I much prefer it this way. But now finally, let's just please get on to talking about the actual songs. The album is divided into three cycles, much like the stages of insect metamorphosis. The first cycle is called the Hierophant, which is rather embarrassingly misspelled in the CD booklet, although it's nothing compared to this typo in Manson's autobiography. I will never get over the fact that he errantly put a Y in the middle of Nietzsche. The Hierophant is a tarot card, number 5 in the Trump deck. On screen, I'm showing Manson's rendition of the Hierophant as part of a series of tarot cards he did for his Hollywood album. From what I've read, the Hierophant seems to represent establishment, learning, pedagogy, instruction, religion, ritual, etc. And then reversing that card means the opposite of those things. I suppose it can be seen as setting the stage for this revolution. Although, I'm not really sure what the Hierophant has to do with the themes of the songs within this cycle, except for maybe the beautiful people. I think most of the songs really don't have much to do with the idea of the Hierophant tarot card, and this cycle really more represents the larval stage of the Antichrist. The first song, Irresponsible Hate Anthem, is basically what the title says. In a later album called Golden Age of Grotesque, Manson wrote a song called Use Your Fist and Not Your Mouth, where he introduces the term black collar. This is a black collar song. Put it in your middle finger and sing along. Use your fist and not your mouth. In talking about it, he said that politicians are always trying to write speeches that appeal to the blue collar crowd. And so he wanted to write a song that was basically an anthem for the people like him, the black collar people, which is basically anti-blue collar. It's a rejection of the salt of America's earth. I think Irresponsible Hate Anthem is an early example of him writing a black collar song, and thus it's kind of patriotic in that sense, but mockingly so. Suicide. I am totalitarian. I got abortions in my eye. Here, America is associated with totalitarianism, a stark contrast from America's perception of itself as a free country, something which it takes a lot of pride in. The totalitarian mindset that Manson criticizes, he also calls it the police state mentality. It's very hampered by the Constitution and the Bill of Rights to some degree, but it's still present in American culture, and we see it in things like the Pledge of Allegiance and the appreciation of the police and the military, the desire to restrict other people's freedoms to do what they like and believe what they want. He also included the music industry in this criticism, and by extension himself, saying that the commercialization of entertainment acts as a sort of distraction from America's more authoritarian tendencies, and it perpetuates the same conformist mindset of these tendencies.
The only thing that troubles me is references to fascism and fascist imagery in your video, which some people may catch depending on their level of sensitivity, and some of the things you say about society not having any obligation to take care of the weak. And you have a lot of impatience around people who are weak, however you define that. Well, and at the same time, you take no responsibility for how people react to your music. But you're messing with really potent ideas that have killed a lot of people in this century or this decade, this year.
The thing is, and not to speak for Canada, but America is very fascist.
but it disguises that in the idea of MTV and the idea of commerciality. And they're very much telling you what you want and what you don't want. And the idea of individuality is a farce. So I've made a point to show to people, almost cynically, the relationship between music and fascism, how it's almost totalitarian. But I've never at any point promoted fascism. I'm making a statement at it.
In saying, "I'd sell you suicide," he is mocking the amoral nonchalance of commercialism. But he's also, I think, using that as kind of a jab of the people who object to his music and that of other rock singers on a moral level.
It seems like you're throwing an anchor to people that are already drowning in a lot of ways. My understanding of rock music and being involved myself is that you have the opportunity to be the voice of a generation and a voice to a generation. I think for some segment of the population, you're doing an important job at being a voice of a generation. There's a lot of hurting kids that I know that can relate to there to what you do. A voice to a generation, I think you're doing a pathetic job. The lack of hope, the greatest needs in the street are hope, trust, and dignity. And I've studied your stuff pretty closely, and there are no signs of it.
A lot of people considered Marilyn Manson and other such rockers as suicide merchants, in a sense. And in fact, Judas Priest were actually brought to court over the issue of a couple of parents thinking their son killed himself over listening to Judas Priest and hearing the subliminal messages telling him to kill himself. So in saying, "I am so all-American, I'd sell you suicide," I think part of that is Manson shifting the blame and saying that, you know, heavy music isn't what makes people kill themselves, but rather living in this conformist authoritarian society where you don't feel like you're allowed to be yourself. But in shifting the blame, I don't think he's absolving himself either. I also think there's kind of an element of, yes, I am a suicide merchant, but that's only because I'm so American, and that is really the most American thing I could be. Commercializing everything to the point of even commercializing your own suicide. Manson has always liked to point out that he is essentially no different from other people.
Do you guys have an obsession with serial killers, or?
No more than the rest of America does. Right. I think it's kind of a reflection of what America's about. Everyone sees me as this bad person because of what I'm saying, but what I'm saying is in everyone.
He actually says something about this in his cover of Rock and Roll Nigger on Smells Like Children.
And the world spreads its legs, and the world spreads its legs for another fucking star.
Manson's Antichrist is a product of the society he was born into. His satanic individualism is the inevitable reaction and the counterweight to America's obsession with conformity. And the violence and suicidality of Manson's music is really a reflection of the violence and suicidality inherent in American culture. So therefore, he really is no different from the rest of America, he's just more honest. And in selling us suicide, he is also selling America its own cultural suicide. The suicide of American values. Because the culture he was raised in is what turned him into what he is, basically he's saying that America created its own destruction via its own sin. Very similar to the way Paul describes it in 2 Thessalonians.
I am totality. I've got abortion in my eyes.
Abortion is a metaphor that Manson uses frequently to refer to rejection. So basically, I've got abortions in my eyes means everything he sees is rejected by him. Everything he sees is an abortion. And this could either be interpreted as him talking about how all-American he is, saying that, you know, America rejects itself, but also as the reaction to that, saying, I reject American values because America rejects my values. In this song, we see a kind of ironic synthesis of the American and the anti-American, sort of like he's saying they're really two sides of the same coin. This song is very vitriolic, it's very angry, and it exists to really excite the senses and to bring about a kind of climax of the anger that we're repressing inside of ourselves. The time for discrimination is mostly past. This anger is very unbridled and undirected. He's basically angry at everything and everyone. I am the law. Mine's a prison. Let's just kill everyone. Your guns are coming out. Prism in this sense meaning a lens through which you view everything that colors your perception of everything. So his hate is basically turning into an all-encompassing ideology. And this song therefore serves as the anthem of that ideology. But the targets of his hatred are still the perpetrators of this ill will or cruelty. But the distinction there is Manson is not saying that he's become basically a complete rageaholic who is mad at innocent people for no reason. It's more that he is so wounded and broken and scarred by all of his experience that he only sees the evil in everyone. He can see the hater or the raper in everyone, and he wants to enact a kind of retribution in kind. Nevertheless, the title of this album is very intriguing because it admits that this reckless hate is irresponsible. And yet it doesn't see that as a reason to deny it. Because there is a time and a place for being irresponsible. There is a responsibility in irresponsibility. And that is largely what rock music is for. I think there is a tendency to mistake what Manson is doing for promoting hate and promoting violence. That's not really the case. What he's really doing is bringing expression, climax, and catharsis to it. And one of the best ways to do that is to commune with a music that really validates those feelings unapologetically. The Beautiful People was the leading single on Antichrist Superstar, and it has one of the best music videos of Manson's career. It had images of Manson and his band playing their song in some sort of a rundown plastic surgery office that at times looks more like a dungeon. There are images of boots marching in lockstep, heads completely covered in bandages, and lots of disturbing, invasive-looking dental equipment, which Manson wears proudly on his face. We also see what I can only assume to be the result of all of this hideous beautification, an unnaturally tall, bald version of Manson in a dress. This version of Manson is shown getting cheered on by a crowd of adoring followers, and then directing them to walk in circles with the waving of his hands. We can assume that these are the same people rhythmically stamping in those boots in the earlier shot. The music video is clearly a satire of beauty and conformity. It shows him going through this hideous process of turning himself into an ugly monster in order to become more beautiful, which is a satire of how people torture themselves to fit into society. But he also acknowledges that beauty is power, and by becoming beautiful, he acquires power over these very vacuous and superficial people with no real values or understanding, who just follow whatever they think is cool at the moment. A culture that tortures itself for attention and enjoys licking the boot. It's basically the same concept he talked about on Cyclops in the previous album. By simply becoming beautiful in a conventional sense, he's able to manipulate and extort these people however he wants. The lyrics of the song appear to be more about virtue than literal beauty. The beautiful people, it's all relative to the size of your steeple. You can't see the forest full of trees. The beautiful people are short-sighted and blind to their own hypocrisy. Their values are based on superficial things like steeple size, which is a criticism of how Orthodox churches and megachurches will flaunt their wealth in order to attract worshipers. But it's also a reference to penis envy, which is made clear in a following verse. The beautiful people want to be right all the time, and they want other people, moreover, to believe that they are right all the time. And Manson, of course, knows that this is ridiculous. Because nobody doesn't have evil in their heart, nobody doesn't have bias or stupidity. But the beautiful people have this mentality that is intolerant toward imperfection. And so in mocking them, he's pointing out all of their moments of imperfection. Yeah, there are a lot of references to monkeys and apes on Manson's early work. The monkey, the man, then the gun. There's even a monkey in the music video I'm talking about. Usually when Manson uses a simian metaphor, he's talking about the primitiveness of mankind. He's talking about mankind as an animal, as something which isn't godlike. And so in saying, "You live with apes, man, it's hard to be clean," he's telling the beautiful people that, hey, you guys aren't gods, you're animals, so start acting like it. But lately, it seems that Manson's love of the monkey has been eclipsed by another animal.
I'm a bee, a king bee, and I will destroy every flower.
Dead as a bee, buzzing inside my head. Take money like an ugly bee, covered in money.
And I will cover the earth in honey, and everyone will eat themselves.
But noses like a beehive, I'm drinking blood honey.
I have a feeling I'm really going to enjoy going into Manson's bee phase, because I found this painting called Fibonacci, which the word Fibonacci is referenced in one of those songs. And also in another song, he talks about bees buzzing inside his head. And so I think that there's some really important symbolism there, but I'm not going to go into it yet, of course. Song number three is titled Dried Up, Tied, and Dead to the World.
You cannot follow your fingers. Say that thing for dollar bills. Kick up my husband, don't touch up from others' lives. Wake up, breakfast, the trash are just wasting time.
It was the most self-recriminating I had ever been, and it wasn't just about myself. I had been part of an epidemic of drug abuse, self-abuse, and insincerity that seemed to be raging through everyone I met in New Orleans. Their motto, "I'll be your lover, I'll be forever, I'll be tomorrow, I am anything when I'm high."
I'll be your lover.
Manson said that most of the songs on this album are about the past and the future, but this is one of the very few that he wrote taking place in the present during the recording of Antichrist Superstar, which was a very chaotic experience for everyone involved, resulting in Daisy Berkowitz leaving the band and a whole host of other just disturbing and disgusting stories that never should have seen the light of day. And unfortunately, I had to read these stories because I read his book. This is also, of course, when he got hospitalized for cocaine. So yeah, Dried Up, Tied, and Dead to the World sounds pretty accurate to how he felt. It was him saying, "Stop doing drugs and literally nothing else. and actually make the album that you came out here to make. I had come to realize that it was more fun looking for drugs and remembering what you did while on them than actually doing them. I may not have always exercised self-control in my life, but when needed, I had the necessary willpower and capacity for self-denial and reserve, facilities at least as strong as anyone else's I had ever encountered. I also had ambition, tremendous ambition, and drugs were now getting in the way of that ambition. One of them had to go. When I first conceived of Antichrist Superstar, I'd set out to create an apocalypse, but I didn't realize it was going to be a personal one. As a child, I had been a weakling, a worm, a follower, a small shadow trying to find a place in an infinite world of light. In the end, in order to find that place, I had to sacrifice my humanity, if you could even call such an insecure, guilt-ridden existence humanity. I had to shed my skin, purge my emotions, and experience every extreme. I had to keep throwing myself onto the swords until I didn't feel a thing. But in trying everything, all I had discovered was that I didn't need any of it. From that point, there was nowhere to go but to the grave, or to become more human. After 7 stressful months of working, or not working, on the album, and dealing with Missy, I had begun to emerge from that soulless cocoon of non-feeling. As the drugs drained out of my system, humanity, tears, love, hate, self-respect, guilt was rushing back to me, but not in the same way that I remembered it. My weaknesses had become my strengths. My ugliness had become my beauty. My apathy to the world had become a desire to save it. I had become a paradox. Now, more than any other point in my life, I began to believe in myself. I had preached it all the time in my music, but had I practiced it since arriving in New Orleans? Had I ever practiced it? Had I ever truly been capable of it before now? The last song of the Hierophant cycle is called Tourniquet, which is a fitting title because it sounds like some of the most delicious, icky, sticky black tar heroin. That being said, I don't really know why it's called Tourniquet. Take your hatred on me. Make your victim my head. You never ever believed in me. I am your tourniquet. The verses were inspired by one of his dreams where he saved little bits of himself like hair and fingernails and then formed a personal companion out of them. She's made of hair and bone, little teeth, things I cannot speak. She comes out like a cripple. It's a powerful and elegant song about trying to hold on to a broken relationship. He constructs this very flimsy girl out of parts of himself and then falls in love with it. So then he's very sad when the relationship fails and this girl falls apart, even though it was inevitably going to fall apart because it was such a flimsy construction. It's a good metaphor for relationships that are built on very flimsy premises. And no matter how tightly he wraps their love in tin foil, the flies will always find their way in. No matter how dearly he attempts to preserve the innocence of their relationship, it will always be corrupted because it was founded on corruption. The butterfly appears everywhere in this music video, and at the end he's even in a room being swarmed by butterflies. And I think that the butterfly is supposed to represent this fragile, delicate innocence that he's trying to preserve. This idea that he has to create somebody out of his own body in order to be happy, but he's still not happy, despite the fact that this person is created specifically to be his companion. Their relationship still falls apart. The next night, as I sat alone in the studio's control room, I played back the rough mixes we had recorded of Tourniquet, a song inspired by one of my many apocalyptic nightmares. I thought I was listening to it to try and determine if it should be redone, but in reality I was trying to find myself in the song, to see if I could discover some clue, some answer, some solution, some way out of the mess my life and career had become. I listened to it again and again until I was numb to it, no longer able to tell if the song was good or bad, or even if it was my own or someone else's. In a daze, I picked up the microphone plugged into the computer, beginning to feel one of the blackouts I had been experiencing more frequently coming on. Very slowly and firmly, I drummed my left hand on the table as if tapping an SOS into a telegraph, and whispered into the microphone, "This is my most vulnerable moment." I flipped the waveform around so that it was backwards, and added it to the beginning of the song, a distress call heard by no one but myself. I collapsed into the swivel chair and tried to clear my head. The words came from a place inside me as pink and sensitive as the head of a newborn baby. I wondered if the debased, demoralized, degraded monstrosity that I had become was dying or being murdered, making way, as Anton LaVey had predicted over a year ago, for something new, for something confident, for something emotional, for something terrible and beautiful and powerful. For Antichrist Superstar, a world redeemer that no one would allow to be born.
Little Horn is born!
Second cycle is called Inauguration of the Worm, and it consists of 7 songs. It represents the transformation of the worm into the angel with the scabbed wings. The first song, of course, is called Little Horn. This song introduces the idea of the Antichrist into this album through the image of the little horn from Daniel chapter 7. And to accompany this grand introduction, he sets the stage with a bunch of very confusing images from many of his apocalyptic nightmares. Yeah, this song exists on a plane beyond me. Your blind have now become my deaf. I take this to mean that God relies on his followers being blind to the truth and blindly following him. And so when the Antichrist takes away God's followers, they become his deaf, in that his message is falling on deaf ears. His message of individuality and self-determination is being loved but not really appreciated and understood by people who are just following him because that's what they do. They're followers. They are not individuals. They don't self-determine. And so there's a kind of paradox where the Antichrist is ironically just participating in this very same conformity that he is trying to fight against. The next one is something quite special. It's called Cryptorchid. Cryptorchidism is a condition where one or both of the testes fails to descend from the abdomen into the scrotum, which is a prenatal development that some people just don't go through properly. And so I think this is supposed to symbolize kind of weakness and insecurity and a feeling of stunted development. Seven is a very important number in Revelation. It was written down as an epistle to the seven churches of Asia Minor. The Lamb has seven horns and seven eyes opening the seventh seal. The angels, the seven angels, blow the seven trumpets. There's the seven crowns on the heads of the red dragon. Going back to Genesis, God created the world in 6 days and rested on the seventh. The seventh day has been the rest day for Jews ever since then. Noah brought seven pairs of every clean animal into the ark, and the famine of Pharaoh Joseph lasted for 7 years, following another 7 years of plenty. There is plenty of occult significance to the number seven, and it is theorized that the number six represents incompleteness, where seven represents completeness, so therefore 666 would be thrice incomplete. Learning the number seven, therefore, could be a metaphor for living up to your full potential. It could also be about godliness and wanting to be godly and never being able to be godly. So that would be his moral failing. Or perhaps godliness refers less to conformity to the way of the beautiful people and more toward becoming your own God. The fact that he's never able to reach that point where he becomes his own God, and he's always stunted in this stage of cryptorchidism where he is relying on the values and opinions of other people to lead him. So I guess cryptorchid as a song could be a moment in your mind where you're thinking, man, I'm still here. Why am I still in the same position? I should be doing all kinds of cool stuff, but I'm stuck here because I'm weak. Each time I look outside, his back changing shape is, of course, a reference to him sprouting his wings. It could also have something to do with that thing he mentioned about his ribs jutting out of his skin like serrated knives. There's another reference to his pointy ribs on the song Man That You Fear, and if you look at the CD booklet, the excellent CD booklet, you'll see on one side of the booklet, here's him as the worm, and he slowly transforms into the angel with the scabbed wings. And I'll just show you the whole thing right here. Here's him as his final form as the angel. But this moment in particular, I want to highlight, because here you can see he has an anatomical drawing, like a Grey's Anatomy drawing of a rib cage that is flipped upside down on top of a blurred image of him. And it resembles wings, sort of like he's growing wings. So that is another connection between pointy ribs and wings. There seems to be some sort of a symbolic connection between those two things in Manson's mind, although I'm not quite sure exactly what the origin behind that idea is. This song has a lot to do with his mother. He is seen betraying his mother in some way. I don't know if this is his actual mother. I think rather the idea of mother is used as a symbol, a shorthand for the person who sort of sees him as a child or in that stage of childlike innocence and holds on to that image of him the longest, basically in betraying his mother or causing his mother to die, whether metaphorically or literally. He is basically losing that innocence that his mother loved so much. This song really is about that point of no return. And quite possibly this song is also supposed to represent the moment when the worm grows his wings. The first half of the song sounds very creepy and spooky, which matches the kind of idea of fear and guilt being experienced by this character. But then, very interesting, about halfway through, it changes suddenly, and we get this lovely sort of serene mellotron flute chord progression. And the mellotron flute is the same instrument used at the beginning of Strawberry Fields Forever, which is a song that Manson used to sing a lot on stage. And it creates this absolutely gorgeous effect. And just like that, we get a choir of angelic Mansons.
Break your finger, it is done. The moon has now eclipsed the sun. The angel has spread its wings. The time has come, the bitter things.
And then it just keeps going.
Break your finger, it is done. The moon has now eclipsed the sun. The angel has spread its wings. The time has come, the bitter things.
This incantation is repeated many times, and as it repeats, the music starts to swell in ways that, oddly enough, remind me of a lot of the sounds on the first Enya album, an album that I am quite fond of. This incantation represents a ritual or a prophecy of some sort that inaugurates the worm into his new body. Prick your finger, it is done, referring to a blood oath or a blood ritual to seal the deal. The moon has now eclipsed the sun. The solar eclipse is the moment where darkness triumphs over light, kind of like the chaos serpent Apophis swallowing the sun. The angel has spread its wings. The time has come for bitter things, prophesying his eventual rebirth as the disintegrator. This incantation is one of the most brilliant pieces of musical craft on the record. It's one of those things where no matter how many times it's repeated over and over, it never stops being interesting. And not only that, this is not the last time we will see this incantation on this album. They did make a music video for this song, but it was really just a montage of clips from Begotten, which was cut together by the director of Begotten, E. Elias Marriage, who also created a music video for the title track, Antichrist Superstar, which was kind of underwhelming. The Crypt Orchid video also contains a clip of Manson ripping his own guts out, which is a reference to the self-disemboweling scene at the beginning of Begotten. Yeah, this is a weird movie. You kind of have to be a strange person in order to actually be entertained by it. Trust me, it's not as interesting as it looks. The next two songs are a little bit on the confusing side, in my opinion. They're called Deformography and Worm Boy. When I look back at the lyrics of Antichrist Superstar, I can't remember when I wrote them. I can't place a specific time or day or if they came from me. There are songs on the album that are innately written from my point of view, and there are some that are from some personality that I don't understand that I've decided to label Antichrist Superstar. Just because I'm done with the album doesn't mean I understand it any more than anyone else who is going to listen to it. Wow, I guess even he doesn't know what he's talking about. That makes my job a lot easier. What I can gather is that Deformography is a portmanteau of deform and pornography.
Lift you up like the sweetest angel. I tear you down like a whore.
I wasn't really sure what it meant to be deformed in your porn, so I did a quick control F search out of desperation for deform in The Long Hard Road Out of Hell, and the one thing I found was this paragraph, which might serve as a clue to getting us closer to understanding what this line means. The doctors explained that Missy was 3 months pregnant, and if she decided to have an abortion, she would have to wait until her flu went away. I knew during the course of our long relationship I had deformed her personality to suit my own. Now I realized that I had deformed her body as well. Let me see if I can piece this together. There's an aspect of the song which is clearly about some sort of obsessive hero worship or romantic infatuation, and the dangers of that, like when he says, "Your star is so sharp, it leaves me jagged holes." He also says, "You are the one I want, and what I want is so unreal." Which indicates that he is so obsessed with this person that he has a malformed or deformed image of her in his mind. Which I guess is what deformography means. The porn in this case is his own mental image of this person who he has twisted and distorted to the point where it doesn't even resemble the person who he thinks he's perceiving. However, other lyrics seem to suggest a more reciprocal quality to this deformography.
I am the one you want, and what you want is so unreal.
And that might make this pre-chorus and chorus a little bit less confusing.
I fell into you.
The lyrics seem to describe some sort of betrayal or a feeling of betrayal, which Manson experienced a lot during Antichrist Superstar. Overall, this song really communicates a kind of attachment to other people and a need for other people to validate you, which is something that Manson grew to despise. He despised hero worship and he despised obsessive attachment to other human beings. And the various betrayals he experienced in his life are what really put him on this direction into finding his individuality and self-reliance. The next one is an absolute romp.
When you get to heaven, you will wish you were in heaven.
Worm Boy kind of comes out of nowhere because most of the songs prior to this have been all creepy or very loud and screamy, but then suddenly there's this song that's just like this eccentric, crazy Daisy Berkowitz fueled awesomeness that really reminds me of My Monkey. That has led some people to think that this song doesn't fit very well on this album, and I'll admit when you're first listening to the album, it does kind of feel jarring and out of place, but I'm telling you, man, if you learn to appreciate Worm Boy, it is a lot of fun. But lyrically, it seems to have a lot of different ideas running through it, and I struggle to find a common thread of connection between them.
When will you realize you're already there? So water down, your feelings have turned to mud. Love everybody is destroying the value of all hate has got me nowhere.
Okay, this part is very confusingly worded. Love everybody is destroying the value of what exactly? I think he's trying to say it's destroying the value of love, because that's something he has said in other places as well.
I was reading somewhere, I think it was in Option magazine, you were talking about the idea, or you believe in the idea of survival of the fittest. Yeah. And social Darwinism.
Mm-hmm.
About being strong.
Mm-hmm.
But how does that reflect into society? How the idea that society tries to take care of the weak, is that a pointless pursuit?
I just think it's something that people need to think about more. In America, through the part of Christianity, we're raised to love everybody. And I think when you love everyone, that really depreciates the value of love. You know, the things that I love, I would die for and I care deeply for. But I couldn't say that I loved everything, or it would have no value. And the same thing goes for hate.
If it was all hate, there would be...
You need the whole cosmos. You need it all.
I wasn't very convinced by this idea that loving everybody somehow waters down the feeling of love. But then I went back to the original source of the idea, the Satanic Bible, and I read what Anton LaVey had to say about the subject. And I think I got a better understanding of what Manson was trying to communicate. You cannot love everyone. It is ridiculous to think you can. Even if you love everyone and everything, you lose your natural powers of selection and wind up being a pretty poor judge of character and quality. If anything is used too freely, it loses its true meaning. Therefore, the Satanist believes you should love strongly and completely those who deserve your love, but never turn the other cheek to your enemy. Love is one of the most intense emotions felt by man. Another is hate. Forcing yourself to feel indiscriminate love is very unnatural. If you try to love everyone, you only lessen your feelings for those who deserve your love. Repressed hatred can lead to many physical and emotional ailments. By learning to release your hatred towards those who deserve it, you cleanse yourself of these malignant emotions and need not take your pent-up hatred out on your loved ones. Every Pharisaical religionist claims to love his enemies, even though when wronged, he consoles himself by thinking, God will punish them. Satanism has been thought of as being synonymous with cruelty and brutality. This is so only because people are afraid to face the truth, and the truth is that human beings are not all benign or all loving. Just because the Satanist admits that he's capable of both love and hate, he is considered hateful. On the contrary, because he is able to give vent to his hatred through ritualized expression, he is far more capable of love, the deepest kind of love. By honestly recognizing and admitting to both the hate and the love he feels, there is no confusing one emotion with the other. Without being able to experience one of these emotions, you cannot fully experience the other. It seems that Anton LaVey's Satanist religion found a way to turn hate into a positive thing by sublimating it through ritualized expression, which is, I think, the same thing that Marilyn Manson was trying to do with Antichrist Superstar. Overall, the lyrics of Worm Boy seem to represent a moment of critical self-doubt. I know I'm slipping. Oh no, it is everything they said it was. I am everything they said I was. When you get to heaven, you'll wish you're in hell. There's a lot of fear in the air on this track, and I think that's why it's called Worm Boy. But it's also peppered with this voice, and I don't know exactly who this voice is. Maybe it's the worm's future self, but he's basically acting as a counterweight to all this fear and doubt, saying things like,
when will you realize you're already here?
You'll thank us now that you have crossed over.
Don't pick the scouts or you will never hear.
No one shut up, says the world, it's his wings.
These lyrics indicate that the power is already in his hands. All he has to do is seize it. But the doubt that is nagging him makes it hard for him to push forward. I suppose the music choice is suitably chaotic for a song which expresses such anxiety. The next song is comparatively easy to interpret. It's very straightforward with its metaphors, but it's still very lyrically elegant, and it contains that germ of wry, tongue-in-cheek humor that really makes Marilyn Manson so entertaining.
Hey, 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 Mr. Superfuck! I wanna go down on you! Hey, Mr. Super God!
It's about having a bunch of sycophantic hero-worshipping fans who kind of ruin your life because they love you so much. I also love the repeating refrain that closes out this song. It's very David Bowie. If taken in the context of the premise, as of the concept album, if viewed more like a rock opera, this could be the moment where the Antichrist realizes that his message has fallen on deaf ears. He realizes that this revolution he's trying to set up isn't actually coming to fruition because the people who are following him are doing just that. They're following him. They're not following their own path of individuality. They are instead replacing their old idols with new idols that are just anti-establishment versions, slave morality in a way.
You've got to think for yourself. You're all individuals.
Yes, we're all individuals.
So at this point, he has very little choice but to just end it all. Because these people are so thoroughly corrupt that nothing he can do can really save them from their own ignorance. Later in the song Antichrist Superstar, he is shown embracing the fact that everybody worships him and considers him an idol, and basically just using them and exploiting them as his little pawns.
You'll bring me up with your
I love the image of him riling up the crowd like this, like he's conducting them as an orchestra. And the reason he's able to rest easy, the reason that he's able to get excited about this, is because he has abandoned this idea that he needs to save people from their own ignorance, and he has now realized his purpose as the disintegrator, as the Antichrist, is actually to lead people astray with false delusions so that he can lead them to their own destruction so that they may be purged from the world, inaugurating something better, or at least the hope of something better. But before we get to that song, there are two others that we have to talk about that close out this cycle: Angel with the Scabbed Wings and Kinderfeld. When I listen to this song, I always imagine it like a guy frantically galloping into the village on horseback to warn people of their own doom, to warn people of this great menace of death and infertility that's sweeping over the countryside like a big force of nature. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. Can you say that again? And the fact that Manson sings this song in the third person is a great way of communicating that kind of fear. Like, He is the great destroyer. Fear him. The sound of this track exudes panic and awe, like you're looking at a big explosion or a volcanic eruption from far away, and watching as that shockwave just races toward you. It's easily one of the best tracks on the album for its energy and for its apocalyptic world-ending lyrics. Finally, in this cycle comes Kinderfeld, the song that Manson wrote about his perverted grandfather. The thing about the trains is that whenever Jack Warner would go down into his masturbation cave, he would turn on this model train set, which would make a lot of noise so that while he was watching porn or whatever he was doing, the sound coming out would be blurred out by this train noise.
Boys all smell like children.
Kneeling on broomsticks was something that Manson's grandparents used to make him do as a punishment. Back when this song was a demo in 1995, it was called Smells Like Children, and this version of the song they used to play on tour back in 1995, but it didn't at that point have all those references to worms getting wings and other Antichrist Superstar stuff, so it was reworked later, and this chorus was added into it.
And I got my rings and I never even knew that when I was thought I couldn't.
A leitmotif of this chorus actually appears earlier on Worm Boy. It's giving you a taste of what is to come, kind of like a prophecy. The same thing happens when the incantation at the end of Cryptorchid is repeated on Antichrist Superstar, at the point when the Antichrist has reached his pinnacle of power and influence, and begins his role as the disintegrator.
Rip your finger, it is done. The moon has now eclipsed the sun. Angel has spread its wings.
What I like about the use of these leitmotifs is that they give this album an overall air of fate and destiny, predetermination, very much like how the real-life Antichrist is predetermined. We know that eventually an Antichrist is going to come and lead people away from God, inaugurating the Second Coming. We just don't know when it's going to happen. It makes this whole thing feel like it was set up from the beginning. The third and final cycle on Antichrist Superstar is called Disintegrator Rising, and this represents the Antichrist in the form of the Disintegrator, the destroyer of worlds, whether real worlds or mental, metaphorical worlds. The inauguration of the worm was about showing him discovering his power, but then realizing that he actually can't use his power to save the people, and so the only other option is to destroy them. The time has come
for bitter things.
And I normally wouldn't do this, but the lyrics sheet for Kinderfeld is actually very illuminating, and it shows things about the lyrics that I wouldn't be able to understand otherwise. So I'm actually going to go through the lyrics bit by bit and tell you what I mean. The first bit is clearly him talking about his grandfather, he lives inside my mouth and all that, but then we get this pre-chorus that says, tell me something beautiful, tell me something free, tell me something beautiful, and I wish that I could be. Now this goes back, of course, to the beautiful people where he says, now, in that context, I think he was using the word free to mean free of charge, or valueless, easy, basically criticizing the way people are thought of if they don't fit into the paradigm of beauty or conformity. And in the context of Kinderfeld, I think it can be read in a similar light, except it's not about the people being thought of as free, but rather the platitude, or the idea that the worm is feeding on. In the CD booklet, we see that this pre-chorus is being sung by the worm himself. And as Manson said on The Beautiful People, the worms will live in every host. It's hard to pick which one they eat the most. So this pre-chorus portrays his mind as the worm, as this creature that wants to feed off of other people's values, other people's judgments, and mindlessly believes that the beautiful people have it right and wants to be like the beautiful people. But then it says in parentheses, then I got my wings and I never even knew it. When I was the worm, thought I couldn't get through it. Again, we see this idea of him having the power all along but not realizing it. We saw that in Worm Boy, where he says, when will you realize you're already here? And so this song, Kinderfeld, kind of represents a summary of the worm's journey up until that point, of him discovering himself. And I guess that, sort of like how John of Patmos, or no, not John of Patmos, sort of like how the writers of the Book of Daniel were thinking back to the Babylonian captivity when they wrote their piece against Antiochus IV, or like how John of Patmos went back and looked at that apocalypse and then brought that back in his time in talking about the Roman Empire. We see a sort of recap of this idea of the metamorphosis of the worm as we start to enter into the third and final cycle of him realizing his destiny as the one destined for destruction, which could be seen, taken in two ways, either destined for his own personal destruction or the destruction of the world. But in some way, it is his destiny to destroy. And so Kinderfeld, I guess, is that moment of understanding. Then on the CD booklet, we get this part that's labeled in brackets, the inauguration of the worm. And this comes at a moment in the song where he's clearly saying something, but it's also clearly not the inauguration of the worm. It sounds a little bit more like, this isn't the only time when there's a discrepancy between what's written in the lyric sheet and what's said in the actual song. The most egregious example of this comes in 1996 when the phrase, what I hate about me in the song is represented in the lyric sheet as misanthropy, which doesn't even sound similar. I really don't know why these discrepancies exist, but maybe it's for the same reason that he misspelled Hierophant and Nietzsche. I guess he's just not very particular about getting everything accurate. But then we get a message from a voice we have not heard yet, which says, because today is black, because there is no turning back, because your lies have watered me, I have become the strongest weed. Perhaps this is the voice of the disintegrator, the final form of the Antichrist, which we haven't seen yet. And as we see, he's been taking from the Chauncey Gardner school of metaphor and employing some fabulous botanical analogies. The lies of the beautiful people made him want to be like them. But in believing their lies, he also came to realize and believe their story that he was a weed, a valueless accident, a pest, something which is not accepted in their pure world of beauty and virtue. And so because their lies have built him up to be such a big problem for them, he is now realizing that he can exploit that by becoming an even bigger problem, but only in their minds. It is their twisted perspective which saw him as a weed in the first place, and so in becoming the strongest weed, he is allowing their perspective to feed him. He is feeding off of their anger and hate, and then allowing that to be his revenge against them by making them fear and hate him even more, basically taking advantage of their perception and then flipping it around on them. What was supposed to make him into an outcast and feel lesser, he is now then taking that very same prejudice and making them feel uncomfortable because he has now embraced his role as the outcast.
And I'm wondering, like, what is it shock value? Is it deep meaning? Is it science project? What motivates your work?
It's a little bit of everything. I like to experiment with people's fears, see what motivates them, what scares them. And at the same time, I also sometimes mock the whole sensationalism of it all anyways. Sometimes it seems like I'm trying to be shocking, but I'm mocking the fact that people take it so shocking. Mm-hmm. Shock point's never been the point. Mm-hmm. It's just sometimes easier to get things across to people if you say it in a way that gets their attention more than something else would.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you sort of intentionally bring it way over the top. So play with it. Play with the
sure.
image. Yeah.
If these people weren't so easy to shock, then Manson wouldn't even be trying to shock them in the first place. In fact, I couldn't really locate a part in any interview where he said this, but I know that in my research for this video, I came across interviews where he was talking about how he would ideally like to live in a more of like a traditional 1950s society, which is something that didn't make any sense to me until now, analyzing these lyrics, I see what he's trying to say. He's saying that he likes the idea of innocence. He likes the idea of purity. But because the people's idea of innocence and purity is really so corrupt to the core, he actually has to destroy that and become an icon of edge and darkness as a way to balance that out, so that maybe one day when people have gotten over all of this nonsense, they can actually inaugurate a new age where innocence, true innocence, and true goodness is embraced in a very wholehearted and a very sincere way, that it really isn't embraced in that way by the people who claim to embrace it. That all of the sort of leave it to beaver conservatism is really just a mask covering up the horrible, dirty inner core of American values. Kind of like in his song Wrapped in Plastic, when he talks about the furniture being wrapped in plastic in order to keep the dirt out, but it also keeps the dirt in. We also get a section written through Jack's eyes, and Jack, of course, is the grandfather, although I really don't know what this section means. Maybe one of you in the comments can tell me. It says, "The taste of metal, disintegrator, three holes upon the leather belt. It's cut and swollen, the age is showing." And then this next bit is being said by a character called Boy. "There's no one here to save ourselves." I don't know what this means, and I don't know why it's through Jack's eyes, why Jack is seeing it this way, whatever. But finally, in the song, there's the refrain where the disintegrator says to himself This is what you should fear. You are what you should fear.
And the embodiment of fears, or trying to face your fears through what you do. Mm-hmm. And in a way, if you embody your fear, you almost have some sort of control over your fears.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the way that I've always overcome things that terrified me, by becoming them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, hopefully if people who like our music can learn from that, maybe I shared something with them that means something to them. You know, that's the most that I can try and do, is to make people think.
And confront stuff.
Sure.
Yeah. What is, like, your biggest fear?
Of myself, I guess. Fear of losing control. Because I like so many times to put myself very close to chaos, mm-hmm. but that makes me appreciate control even more.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like you've got control over the chaos, or is it just an attempt at it?
That's an everyday battle, you know, mm-hmm. which makes life worth living. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't that way, it would be pretty boring.
This line can have a dual meaning. On the one hand, it represents Manson embracing his own fears and becoming his own fears in order to defeat them, in order to conquer them, sort of like how, you know, he embraced this idea of him being the Antichrist, which is something he feared as a kid. And in his performances, he emulated Reverend Ernest Angley. I say Ernest Angley because that's how it's spelled, but he pronounces it Ernst Angley, which is stupid. And also emulating his grandfather and just how perverted he is. But then there's the other side of this where he says his biggest fear is himself. So perhaps the suicidal rage and destruction of this disintegrator is a metaphor for the untamed wilderness of his psyche, slowly bringing himself closer to death as he embraces chaos with all of his drug use. And just that the fact is that Manson at this period he was talking about really had kind of a compulsive mentality that was oriented towards doing everything edgy, perverse, and destructive. And I think he was compelled in this direction because something in him felt that he needed to go there in order to desensitize himself, in order to stop being vulnerable to other people's betrayal as he experienced it. But the eventual result of that was he ended up having to wake up out of that stupor. And that is really the spiritual mission that Antichrist Superstar completed in him, that he didn't even recognize before he started making the album. Overall, this song has a very nice, creepy, sophisticated kind of sound. It doesn't really hit you with a lot of intense thrills, but it really engages you. It makes you kind of move with it. And there's this lovely element where when the chorus appears the first time, Manson sings it in this kind of comical falsetto, which is spooky but also silly in that kind of lovely spooky kids way. But then when it comes back the next time, it's much more empowered and you really, really feel what he's saying in the lyrics is coming true. Next, we have the third and final cycle, Disintegrator Rising, finally, and we get the song Antichrist Superstar, the title track of the album. And I've already talked a lot about this track already just because it connects to so many other spots in the album. I mean, this song really is the axle on which the whole album rotates. It shows the Antichrist at the height of his power, willing and totally embracing this idea that he can manipulate and con and intimidate people in order to get his way. Shedding his skin like an insect or like a snake, and this connects him to the serpent in the Garden of Eden, who had an Antichrist-like role, or maybe even a Promethean role if you view it from a Gnostic perspective, where he's basically telling Adam that he can become like God, or he can become his own God in a way, if he eats from the fruit of knowledge, so that he knows the difference between good and evil. He can basically, almost like he can determine for himself what is good and what is evil. He doesn't need to rely on God telling him what to do all the time. And I guess that's really the genesis, to use a turn of phrase, of the snake being a kind of satanic or antichrist-like figure. The snake is also the Hebrew serpent or Canaanite serpent, Leviathan. It's also the red dragon, the seven-headed red dragon of Revelation, and of course the Hydra from Greek mythology. Even the sound of this song is very snake-like in a way that's kind of hard to describe. It just kind of slithers around. You can hear it a lot better in the studio version. In shedding his skin to feed the fake, he is shedding all of his old beliefs, which were given to him by the beautiful people. All of these beliefs that told him he was unworthy, or that his idea of virtue or beauty is not the correct way. And he's getting rid of all of these old beliefs, but then interestingly, he's feeding them to his masses of sycophantic fans. Basically, he's exploiting the fact that he has found his source of liberation in order to con, manipulate, and imprison the very people who are believing in him. Basically, he's kind of becoming one of the beautiful people, but kind of an anti-beautiful people, a false, a sort of inversion of the very same thing that the beautiful people were doing. And this is represented in all the fascist imagery and the televangelist imagery in these performances. He's making the point that in becoming an inversion of this thing he hated, he's really becoming the very same thing he hated. But he's doing it, like I said, as a way to lead people down the path of their own destruction. If you can't beat them, join them by beating them. At the end, there's a bunch of voices repeating the refrain. The same thing is heard at the end of the last track and the beginning of the first track. Perhaps then this album is cyclical. In fact, it is cyclical. Irresponsible Hate Anthem, if you look at the CD booklet, it was recorded 4 months after the album was released. Now, how could they record a song 4 months after it was released? The only explanation of this is that this album exists fourth dimensionally. And perhaps that's why it's so fresh every time I listen to it. But what does this phrase mean, exactly? The guy who ran Nachtkabarett.com was able to trace it back to Aleister Crowley in chapter 2 of his Book of the Law. This chapter was written by Hadit, who is the winged sun disk at the top of the Egyptian stele of revealing. I am the snake that giveth knowledge and delight and bright glory, and stir the hearts of men with drunkenness. I am alone. There is no god where I am. Hadit is a god of power and indulgence, who only respects the strongest and most successful people, kings. I guess we can add Hadit onto the long list of gods and monsters that Manson identifies himself with on this album. Begone, ye mockers. Even though ye laugh in my honor, ye shall not laugh long. Then, when ye are sad, know that I have forsaken you. It's fitting that this line, this paraphrase, was chosen to start and end the album, to act as a bookend. because betrayal, of course, is something that Manson wrote about in The Long Hard Road Out of Hell as being very central to his experience writing this album. What neither I nor anyone else around me realized was that the same corrosive that had stripped away my humanity was also responsible for trying to kill Antichrist Superstar in the womb. Betrayal. It was a word that rattled around my mind like a rusty tin blade every time something went wrong. From my grandparents, to Chad, to my teachers at Christian school, to my first girlfriends, no one had lived up to the roles they acted out in public. They wasted their years trying to live the lies they had created for themselves. Only in private could they really be the demons, hypocrites, and sinners that they really were, and woe betide anyone who caught them at their game, because the only thing worse than a lie is a lie exposed. I thought I had learned to protect myself from betrayal by trusting and placing faith in no one, but in the weeks that followed, I was to experience more betrayal in less time than I ever thought possible. Each one was like a hammer driving a stake deeper and deeper into my chest. And then later, when he describes his success after quitting drugs and recording Dried Up Tide in Dead to the World, he says, "I didn't miss the drugs, and I didn't even mind the betrayals that continued up to and past the point when I turned the completed album into Interscope Records. I had gotten used to the defection, desertion, disloyalty, and double dealing, and I had come to understand that I was bigger than all of that. It wasn't just that I was cold and uncaring. I finally knew what was worth caring about. For perhaps the first time in 27 years, I now knew myself." Yeah, the way he's talking, it's like everybody was against him, which makes me think that maybe he was the problem. I mean, if everyone is betraying you, who exactly is the common denominator in that situation? I'm not really sure that he presents this situation with a lot of self-awareness, is what I'm saying. But I also get that the music industry can be pretty boneheaded, and trying to deal with those idiots while you're trying to make your magnum opus can be quite frustrating. I guess it's interesting, therefore, that he depicts the disintegrator as the arch betrayer of his own flock. In becoming the disintegrator, he is getting revenge on all the people who betrayed him in the past, but he's also becoming one of them. By the way, have you ever heard the demo of Antichrist Superstar? It sounds like a bunch of demons having a party. Following Antichrist Superstar is 1996, which is a little bit strange because the song Antichrist Superstar doesn't actually have those words in it, but 1996 does. This song is a lot of fun because it's very fast-paced, kind of like a punk song. And the lyrics are basically just anti this, anti that, anti dog and anti cat. It's like he's giving up and just deciding to be against everything. Sometimes when he would sing it at concerts, he would do this interesting version where he would recite it more like a spoken word poem, and I kind of dig it.
Anti-money and anti-hate, anti-things are fucked and ain't. Anti-cop! And anti-fun! Here is my anti-president god. Anti-Satan and anti-black. The anti-world is on my back. Anti-gay and anti-dope. I am the anti-faggot pope.
Ooh.
believe in the things that don't believe in me. Now it's your turn to see what I hate about me.
There's some humor in this one. I think it's supposed to be kind of satirical, like it's mocking how people are against so many things and kind of pointing out because everything is so contradictory, you know, he's like against love, he's against hate. It's like he's pointing out the inherent contradictions in a lot of people's simplistic sort of I'm for this, I'm against this. This song kind of sounds like a riot, like you can kind of see the flames coming up as you listen to it.
Light a candle for the sinners, set the world on fire.
And at the end, there's these loud popping noises, which could signify the start of the destruction. But from here, the album takes a very interesting turn with a song called Minute of Decay. Up until this point from Kinderfeld, it had just been building and building with intensity, and then 1996 climaxes it, and then we get this very dark, smoky, kind of low-key track about suicide and depression. It begins with a sample from John Hurt in 1984.
Thought crime is death. Thought crime does not entail death. Thought crime is death. To the past or to the future. To an age when thought is free. From the age of Big Brother. From the age of the thought police.
This is something written in Winston's diary as he writes down all of his thought crimes. In fact, this whole song can be interpreted as being about 1984, and I'll get more into that as we go. These lines are very serious, but also kind of cheeky, which I think very well exemplifies Manson's style. I think it's about feeling dead inside, as that matches the other lyrics on the song.
I feel the empty. I feel the minute of decay.
The idea of everything in the future being dead, of course, could be taken literally, but also metaphorically, the death of ideals, maybe the death of God, or the death, people feeling dead inside, turning into zombies, much like in the apocalyptic nightmare Manson had that inspired a lot of the lyrics on Little Horn. Most of the human race had been turned into zombies for the entertainment of a small elite. There was a strip club where they had reanimated female corpses and made them dance naked in cages made of thick metal bars. Their flesh was covered in boils and gnarled veins, and their hair was falling out in clumps. Their jaws had been wired shut so they wouldn't bite off the dicks of guys around them masturbating. The world had degenerated to such a Sodom and Gomorrah state of sin that it seemed clear that the appearance of the Antichrist and the Second Coming were imminent. While this dystopian future bears some analogous resemblance to 1984, the crucial difference, of course, is that this one is highly sexualized, whereas that in 1984 criminalizes all forms of sexuality. I think Manson in this song is identifying himself with Winston, a character who once had hope of a revolution from the proles to destroy the English Socialist Party tyranny, but then was beaten down and tortured and brainwashed basically into loving Big Brother and losing his hope of that revolution ever coming to bear. Manson described Antichrist Superstar as an album that existed on that edge of hope. And, you know, questioning whether there's hope or no hope. And Minute of Decay really falls in the trough of that waveform. This is the moment where hope is completely dead. Just as Winston was dead after undergoing his thorough brainwashing. At this point, the only other option is suicide or total destruction of the world.
I'm on my way down now. I'd like to take you with me. I'm on my way down.
There's also a part where he says he's whited out his name.
Life is a black and bad hat. I've whited out my name. I'd like a prayer.
Just like O'Brien said he was going to erase Winston from the memory of history.
And do you consider yourself a man?
Yes. If you're a man, you're the last man. Your kind is extinct. We are the inheritors. Do you understand that you're alone? You're outside history.
Manson is whiting out his name, ensuring that nobody ever remembers this moment. He will be erased from eternity. That's how little any of this matters to him. 1984 being a part of Antichrist Superstar is very fitting, since 1984 talks about the very same socio-political issues that Manson talks about on this album, like authoritarianism, thought control, and arbitrary value judgments. As he said in The Beautiful People, capitalism has made it this way. Old-fashioned fascism will take it away. But interestingly, Manson isn't just identified with Winston in this song. He's also identified with Big Brother, because Big Brother is the Antichrist. If you think about it, Big Brother doesn't even exist. He's just there in order to scare people into behaving themselves. Sort of like how the Antichrist is this myth that is created in order to make people fall in line and to make people worry about being led astray, to keep people vigilant so that they won't fall under the sway of a false prophet in the end times. As the Antichrist at the height of his power, Manson's control and influence resembles that of the English Socialist Party. Just as the Antichrist is here to spread a great delusion that brings all of the unfaithful into the slaughterhouse, so the English Socialist Party has this fake war that's going on between Oceania and East Asia, which is really a war being perpetrated by the party on its own citizens. They are telling their citizens that they are empowering them, when in reality they are killing them. They are leading their citizens to their own destruction. And just as the Antichrist is vanquished with the second coming of Jesus, so Winston hopes that Big Brother, or rather the English Socialist Party, will be vanquished by a revolution from the proles. And Minute of Decay, of course, is the moment where that delusion is shattered. The Reflecting God is the big climax of the album, and from a lyrical standpoint, I think it represents the concept of Antichrist Superstar most holistically. If you think about this album as a rock opera, then this would be the moment where he destroys the world. Again, the destruction here seems to be more suicide than world-ending. The lyrics suggest that he just put a gun against his head and then pulled the trigger. But the thing about scar tissue is that it never heals, but it also never bleeds, which allows people to do things like this. So these lyrics suggest that even though he's killing himself, he is somehow impervious to suicide, or at least indifferent to it. Like he's chasing some ideal higher than himself, even though his worldview is so admittedly self-centered. You'll understand when I'm dead. What exactly is giving Manson this immense power of will, this death-defying power of will, is not quite certain to me. Maybe it wasn't even certain to him after all. He said that most of the songs on this album took place in the future. And this is no exception, of course. But in any case, he's now a figure of death-defying power. And he truly now has the right to call himself his own god and to sit in the Temple of Jerusalem. Either that or he's gone completely insane, but I guess if he's the center of his own world, there really isn't much difference between the two.
Your world is an ashtray. We put
This part comes directly before the part where he says, "My world is unaffected, there is an exit here." So he's basically mocking all the people who are crying and screaming for mercy during the destruction of their world, and saying, calling them leeches, which is another version of the worm, saying it's only in their nature to complain, calling them virgins because they feel like they've been cheated out of some life experience that they never got to have. But Manson's world is unaffected because he knows something that they don't know. He can see very clearly that these leeches brought their own destruction upon themselves, that he isn't the person who caused it, they are. And in order to acquire the kind of power that he has, all they have to do is reach out and take it. But because they're so weak, because they're so conditioned, because they're such leeches, they will never have the willpower to do so. And so is that even really a life that's worth living? Do you really just want to live your whole life as a worm, never amounting to anything? What's the point? You might as well die. Given how all these themes have intersected, I think it's easy to summarize this song as being basically a big metaphor for the death of God. In discovering the reflecting God in search of the real God, he realizes that the true God is in himself the whole time. It's this great image of, you know, it's like he went to God, he went on top of the mountain to find God, and all he found was a mirror. And then he has to make of that what he will. It's like something out of some obscure Hindu Vedantic legend. While the rest of the world is reeling in pain from the death of God, and wishing that they could have immortality, wishing for this immortality that they once believed, this life that they believed they would get after death, that would be granted to them by some external entity, Manson realizes his own intrinsic immortality. And he recognizes that the true life is this life. It's life on earth, not in the afterlife. That this is all there is. this is it. He becomes uninterested in the fear of his own death, and in fact intentionally brings himself closer to chaos, embracing his own death, because death is only the completion of life. Many people list The Reflecting God as their favorite Marilyn Manson song, and though I don't really think I have a favorite Marilyn Manson song, I certainly can think of no other song that is as worthy of that designation. Just because, I mean, this is the essence of Antichrist Superstar. This is the essence of what Manson is really about. And it's told so beautifully. I mean, these lyrics are probably the best lyrics on the whole album. The final song, although not the final track on Antichrist Superstar, is called Man That You Fear. Do you remember his cousin Chad, who used to explore their grandfather's basement with him when they were kids? After checking out of the hospital, I booked a flight to Canton, Ohio to attend Chad's wedding. I always felt responsible for Chad, like I had somehow knocked him off his path to becoming an actor or a comedian. There was no specific reason why I thought this, except maybe the guilt that I had escaped Canton while his life was stagnating there. He had nailed himself into that all-American coffin. He had gone to college, gotten his girlfriend pregnant, and now he was going to marry her and be miserable, or worse still, content. Talking to Chad, whose buck-tooth freckled face hadn't changed except for a goatee, I couldn't relate to him anymore. How could he understand being on stage in front of thousands of people yelling his name? Staying up for 3 nights doing drugs and watching people piss, shit, whip, and fist fuck one another for sheer amusement. Trying to go to sleep at night with a chest still bleeding from broken glass and a head gashed open by a microphone stand. We could only talk on a superficial level, discussing the strangeness of his getting married, his wife's wedding gown, and the unfathomable concept of actually having children. The wedding was the first time I had been in a church since I was a kid, and I felt uncomfortable through the long service. I wore my black suit with a red shirt, a black tie, and sunglasses. Everybody seemed to be staring at me disapprovingly. Not only was the priest giving me dirty looks, but so was the rest of my family. As they all piously recited their prayers and sang hymn after hymn, I studied each and every one of them coldly. I imagined walking down the aisle in Chad's place, but marrying a black woman or a gay man and watching the confusion and anger that would result. I imagined responding to the priest's question, "Do you take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife till death do you part?" by dousing myself in gasoline and lighting it. I couldn't figure out why I had turned out so different than everybody else. I had the same education, the same advantages, the same disadvantages. It was then that I came up with the lyric that would end the album. "The boy that you loved is the man that you fear." Afterwards, I walked up to Chad's brother and mother, who explained that they were very upset that I mentioned my grandfather in the press. "Why do you feel the need to tell family secrets?" his mother scolded me. "No one believes what I say anyway," I replied curtly. My grandfather had died the previous Thanksgiving, and the fact that I had decided not to attend the funeral seemed to have resulted in a tacitly agreed pact among my relatives to excommunicate me. Everyone I talked to asked if I was gay or a drug addict or a devil worshipper. No one had anything nice to say, and no one understood anything about me. I wasn't Brian Warner anymore. I was some kind of inexplicable and repulsive slime that had trickled out of a sewer and filthied their manicured lives. Chad seemed too young and too intelligent to be falling into this trap, and all I could think of was, I didn't want to grow up and have to tolerate this life that everyone thinks they're supposed to live. On the other hand, my life was no better, and there had to be something else. After the reception, we drove back to my grandmother's. As everyone sat in the living room drinking wine, eating crackers, and struggling to say something interesting, I stole away and walked downstairs to my grandfather's basement. It looked almost exactly the same. But the train set and the enema bag were gone, and someone had emptied the white medicine cabinet. I reached behind the mirror on the ceiling and the pornography had been removed. I opened up one of the paint cans and the 16mm films were actually still there. I picked up one of them and held it up to the dusty beam of yellow light streaming in through the window, revealing a black man making love to a fat white blonde. I removed another reel of film and stuffed them both in the waistband of my pants. I didn't feel small and scared in the basement anymore. In fact, I felt at home for the first time since I had returned to Canton. I had much more in common with my grandfather now than the innocent kid who used to explore his basement, which was an upsetting realization in light of the fact that moments ago I'd been sitting in church promising myself that I would never grow up. I even wore women's lingerie like my grandfather did, and had engaged in sexual acts far more perverse than the ones in his water sports and anal-only magazines. My grandfather had been the ugliest, darkest, foulest, most depraved figure of my childhood, more beast than human. And I had grown up to be him, locked in the basement with my secrets, as the rest of my family reveled in the petty and ordinary upstairs. Down there, I saw my black, ancient, ineluctable core exposed, like a crab forced out of its shell, dirty, vulnerable, and obscene. For the first time in my life, I was truly alone. On the Remix and Repent CD, the version of Man That You Fear, there is acoustic, and it's subtitled Requiem for the Antichrist Superstar. And the music video for Man That You Fear is based on, it's an adaptation of a short story by Shirley Jackson called The Lottery. It's about a small town in the middle of nowhere in America where people draw lots every year to figure out which one of them will be sacrificed in order to ensure a good harvest. In the music video, of course, Manson is the one being sacrificed as he is stoned to death by his friends and neighbors. A very fitting analogy. Explaining just what I had hoped the story to say is very difficult. I suppose I hoped by setting a particularly brutal ancient rite in the present and in my own village to shock the story's readers with a graphic dramatization of the pointless violence and general inhumanity in their own lives. So she's using shock as her medium in order to tell a parable through symbolism about scapegoating and common brutality. It's a very Manson-ish idea. I can tell why Manson really took to this story and why he decided to adapt it in one of his videos. Of the 300-odd letters that I received that summer, I can count only 13 that spoke kindly to me, and they were mostly from friends. Even my mother scolded me. "Dad and I did not care at all for your story in the New Yorker," she wrote sternly. "It does seem, dear, that this gloomy kind of story is what all you young people think about these days. Why don't you write something to cheer people up?" And in fact, like Manson's work, The Lottery by Shirley Jackson was a very controversial story when it came out, and it was banned in several areas, including the entire country of South Africa, who banned it because they thought it was about apartheid. It's kind of like when Carl Sagan sued Apple for codenaming one of their computers Butthead Astronomer. They basically were admitting that apartheid was a brutal and nasty tradition, and because otherwise, why would it even occur to them that this American story about human sacrifice had anything to do with them? The only reason that they could think that is if they knew that they were evil. It also kind of reminds me of how the Facebook idiot Josh Feuerstein went on Fox News and went on a big tirade about how Starbucks removed Merry Christmas from their holiday cups, which he interpreted as an attack on his religion. But more likely, he was just looking for something to get angry at that day to rant about on his Facebook page, and he just happened to visit a Starbucks that morning. This kind of controversy just appeals to people who want something to get angry over. And that's why Manson had so many haters and protesters. It gives people a way to let off some steam, you know? It gives people some excitement in their lives to feel like they're doing something really important when they're really just bickering over some minutia that doesn't really matter. When the man that you fear is really just a man cranking a music box next to a dancing monkey, it's hard to really be afraid. Maybe these fears distract people from their all-encompassing fear of hell, and by extension, their fear of themselves. In the song, Manson is singing to an unknown person, and I choose to interpret it as his mother, because this is the same person he talked about in Cryptor Kid as somebody who knew him during his moment of childhood innocence. And on this song, Man That You Fear, he's speaking to somebody who knew him in that stage. So I think it would be fitting if he were singing this to his mother. Apple has been rotting. Apple, a fruit metaphor for children. Her child has been corrupted. He's now completely dead inside, has no love for his mother anymore, and is now indifferent to her. She will go down just like the rest of them, unimportant and unloved. The person who valued him most in his moment of childhood innocence now means absolutely nothing to him. The song begins with a vivid and grotesque depiction of lost hope, as well as an Orwellian portrayal of the complete destruction of the human spirit.
Let's all in the sugar. Muscles at our feet while on the other side. The screen is us and what's in me.
The last time we spoke, you mentioned your television theory that we're on the other side of the TV and reality is what we're watching. Man That You Fear sort of deals with that. That is the first song, and that is why it's the last song, because it foresees its own end. It's kind of like a resignation. People will see it as a suicide end or a failure, but for me it's an almost, if you can't beat them, join them. It's accepting things for the way they are. And whether that's dying in your mind or dying in the world or if it's being born again or whatever, that's going to be for people to decide how they really want to apply that. But for me, that was the way for me to finish the whole thing. Okay, he didn't explain the TV metaphor at all in that paragraph, but like I said, I do believe it's Orwellian, at least to some extent. I think, you know, it would be weird if there were no connection to the many screens in 1984 of Big Brother watching you, reminding you that you're not watching TV, the TV is watching you. And that, of course, is the destruction of the human spirit. It's interesting that Manson chose to end the album on a note of failure, or at least a note of resignation. Like whatever the Antichrist had hoped to achieve with his revolution didn't pan out. Or perhaps whatever successes he did attain came at a massive cost. And that is solidified with the refrain that ends this song. Perhaps this means that in becoming a rock star or a destroyer of worlds or pursuing his highest degree of excellence, whatever that thing is, he has lost something that is intrinsic. He has lost what's most important to him, which is his humanity.
Stay with them, stay to my pointy rims are all.
This is a line he took from one of his really old Spooky Kids songs called Lucy in the Sky with Demons, with Lucy spelled L-U-C-I like Lucifer. A lot of the lyrics on this song also made it onto Angel with the Scabbed Wings. Like I said earlier, abortion in Manson's music represents rejection, so abortion cribs is this idea of raising a child in an environment that rejects who that child really is. Essentially, you're, without knowing it, you're rejecting your own child at birth. And the bit about the pointy ribs, obviously we covered how in the booklet we see the ribs representing wings, but and that's kind of an empowering symbol, but then here it's flipped around and his pointy ribs being spread open. It's like he's this decaying, desiccated corpse that's being then dissected, and they're spreading open his body to reveal all of the damage that made him who he is, all of the ways in which his insides have been traumatized and scarred. Perhaps this reveals that all of his attempting to change himself to become something was really driven out of a kind of fear. But also it shows how, you know, the people's sins are what created their destruction. They open up the dead body of their destroyer to find all of their sins, to find all of their infants which they had put in these abortion cribs. They see how their rejection of their own race is what created this reaction against that rejection. The man that they fear is the inevitable outcome of their crimes. Collapse me like a weed. Someone had to go this far. I love how he repurposes the weed metaphor from Kinderfeld. But while Kinderfeld, it was empowering. Because your lies have watered me, I have become the strongest weed. Here he's saying, pinch the head off, collapse me like a weed. Somebody had to go this far. The weed now represents weakness and fragility. Track 99. Yeah, I guess there were like 82, 83 other tracks on there that we missed, but oh well. Track 99 is a weird kind of sound collage of different weird voices and noises, with one of the voices that's kind of hard to hear delivering a final monologue from the Antichrist. To spare you the headache of listening to it, I'll recite the whole thing for myself. Go ahead and build a better Messiah. We can dig another grave. This is your calling. If you are hearing this, there's nothing I can do. Something has grown in my chest and I have seen it. It is cold and hard. It has been dormant for many years. I have tried to save you, but I cannot come to save you. This is what you deserve. This is what we deserve. This is something we have brought upon ourselves. We are not a victim. You are not a victim. We are not a victim. You are not a victim. God will grovel before me. God will crawl at my feet. These are the dying years. These are the dying years. When you are suffering, know that I have betrayed you. The Antichrist here speaks to us in first person plural, counting himself among us, because even though he has his scabbed wings, he is still human. He includes himself as among the many people whose sins have brought about their own destruction. And unlike in Daniel and Revelation, this apocalypse is shown without a hopeful ending. And that's probably because the Antichrist never lives to see the world rejuvenated. He dies as a way to bring about that rejuvenation. Only through his death could it be achieved, and he becomes one of the many souls sent to the lake of fire. The New Jerusalem wasn't made for people like him. He's just the most wicked of the many damned. Those who die in the apocalypse are the earth's rejects, the aborted of God. There are many lines in Hollywood that describe something like this, but to give you a taste of it, I'll read one from A Place in the Dirt. He says, "We are damned and we are dead, all God's children to be sent to our perfect place in the sun, in the dirt." But as a counterweight to all this melancholy moping, he makes it very clear that we deserve this. This is our own doing. We did this to ourselves. He accepts his fate because he recognizes it as the inevitable and necessary end of his life. But even though this album seems to end in a note of failure, there is still this very small kernel of hope there. There is still this glowing ember illuminating a tombstone that spells out, "Unless," much like in another apocalyptic tale, The Lorax. As long as we keep making the same mistakes, we are dooming ourselves to the same destruction over and over. It is Manson's hope that through this destruction, somehow, some way or another, whether it's the destruction of the mind or ideals or old values or one's own life, some way people will realize that the power is within themselves, it's not out there, and they will begin to find their own salvation as true individuals.
In your life, is there an opportunity for salvation? Like, I cling to my salvation pretty intensely. Do you understand salvation?
That's what my whole record's about, what I struggled through, and I think the answer in the end is your only salvation is yourself, and that was my answer at the end.
They will become their own messiahs, and they will no longer see the need to keep building up more to be destroyed with every new age. What really strikes me as central after going through all these songs is that Antichrist Superstar really does exist on that edge of hope. The fact that the central theme of the destruction of the world can be interpreted in either a hopeless or a hopeful light is enough to put the album on that edge. Depending on how you view it, the apocalypse of St. John could be a very empowering and a very hopeful story about the rejuvenation of the world through the destruction of the old world. But it could also be interpreted as the final victory of the beautiful people, and therefore a hopeless end of the human spirit and the will to live. An act of genocide by God against all of his undesirables, all of his infants and abortion cribs. The final triumph of virtue over corruption.
I hate purity. I hate goodness. I don't want virtue to exist anywhere. I want everyone corrupt.
Well, I ought to suit you then. I'm corrupt to the core.
And with this comes the death of thought, the death of dialectic. Antichrist Superstar raises a lot more questions than it answers. Despite what you might at first imagine about Marilyn Manson, he doesn't really spend a lot of time telling you what he thinks. Instead, he just draws a lot of parallels between things to get you to start questioning your own beliefs and to stop taking things so much for granted.
It's basically just rock and roll, but he's asking questions, and most music doesn't ask any questions. It provides answers, but it doesn't stimulate you to think. And you look at the videos, you look at the music, and their images, which are disturbing and are strange and bizarre and beautiful and weird, but you know, they're asking, you know, what is this? And you don't really have a ready answer.
It's very easy to misinterpret Antichrist Superstar because it's almost a record that is designed to be misinterpreted. It's part of the joke that a lot of people aren't gonna get it, and that feeds into the concept of it. The most common mistake is taking the things that he says at face value, and thus coming out with the impression that Antichrist Superstar is an album that promotes hate or nihilism or violence, or social Darwinism even. This is actually a mistake that I made up until I made this video, because until I really sat with it and really tried to understand it and really read between the lines to look at the subtext of what he's saying and did all the research and all that, until I could do that, I like everyone else, took it for what it was. But what it is really one half of the dialectic. The other half of the dialectic, the half that isn't spoken. Everyone knows that good and virtue and beauty are great things, but nobody really stands up for evil and Satan and corruption. So what Manson is trying to do is fill in the other half of that dialectic, that needed half, that gets people thinking about the world in a more accurate way. He's playing devil's advocate in a literal and figurative sense. I used to think it was very concerning that Manson wrote so much about personal empowerment through anger and hate, and not once was there a single reference to inner peace being a source of empowerment. And I'm not the only good faith actor who has picked up on this.
We've kind of kept hitting on this idea of what Marilyn is doing as a reflection or a mirror of society, okay? That he's mirroring either society's fascination with serial killers or a fascination with self-mutilation, depression, okay? And maybe he is a good mirror of society, and maybe, you know, maybe he does a good job of that. But I think what he doesn't do is, I don't think he does it with a sense of compassion. Okay, because I've read interviews where you've kind of given me the impression that you basically, you know, don't give a damn whether your fans live or die. Because I think I remember you saying in a couple of interviews that if someone had killed himself because of something that he felt inspired you, I'm not saying it's your fault. I mean, it's obviously his, but there's some sort of influence going on that it wouldn't really bother you that much. And, okay, I'll cut to the chase. What I'm saying, though, is that it's one thing to say you're a reflection of a society, but what I really want to know is, if you're just getting people to reflect and think about their own pain and confront it, okay, I mean, that's valid. But what I'm saying, what do you do afterwards? What do you give them to replace it with? I mean, it seems with you the pain and understanding of it is just an end in itself rather than a means to self-realization.
Well, we talk a lot about hate, but the idea of love is important too. And in America, North America for that matter, love is, you know, the concept of love thy neighbor, I think, is ridiculous because, you know, the things that I love, I would die for. But if you love everything, it has absolutely no value.
I wouldn't agree with that, because it reminds me of something I read in an article about Lou Reed when they were talking about the difference between a pessimist and a nihilist. They're saying that a nihilist essentially believes that things like universal love and everything is a bad joke, and it's just not worth realizing. But a pessimist, which I consider myself, and I think, you know, could be something to strive towards, is someone who thinks that love and acceptance is incredibly hard and maybe hardly ever happens at all. But the very fact that it's possible means that it's worth going for. I mean, I agree.
I'm saying I love things and I would die for them, but if you pass out love openly, then this has no value. So this idea of compassion that you have, you know, I care for people who are intelligent. That's why I say, don't be an idiot. If you're smart enough to realize, don't kill yourself over a rock album, then I love you.
Yeah.
If you're an idiot, kill yourself.
But why should you love?
Happy.
Okay, but why should you love people only who you think are fit?
I think Mr. Red Shirt Man has some valid criticisms of Manson's satanic philosophy. And the disagreement here really, I think, comes down to hope. Red Shirt Man is still clinging on to some kind of hope. But Manson had become dead to the world. His only hope lay in his own willpower, and in closing himself off the world, off from the world, so that nobody could hurt him again. But of course, this isn't, when I say Manson is this way, I'm not talking about the man himself. I'm talking about what he is showing in Antichrist Superstar, this side of him, the hopeless side. And then there is the implicit other half of it, which is kind of, it relates to the transformation that he went through when making this. How in bringing himself closer to chaos and in becoming scarred and therefore impermeable, he reached a critical point where that couldn't go on. And so he had to find his balance in life. He had to find the balance between emotionality and humanity and power. And I really do get where he's coming from. I get where Manson is coming from on a lot of the hate stuff because, you know, I have contempt for pretty much everyone. If someone comes up to me interrupting my train of thought, my immediate response is to hate him. Does that make me a bad person? Probably. Does that make me a sad person? If I let it get to me, can I change it? No. But do I even want to change it? Again, no. I oddly like being a misanthrope. I enjoy my own suffering. I like being the villain. And I think there's more to it than simply good against evil, right against wrong, healthy versus unhealthy. I think there's a deeper wisdom in the part of the villain. There's a wisdom in carving out your own truth and rejecting what's in front of you. Villains play an important role in the cosmic order of things. And while yes, sure, evil is ugly and unpleasant if you're downwind of it, it is also inevitable, though. So from there, there's a choice to be had. Will you reject evil? Or will you look it face to face, see it eye to eye, and confront it with poise? Until you understand evil and relate to it on a human level, you're never really going to get over your fear of it. It's always going to control you, and so you're always going to be a worm. I dislike the world around me. I hate the world. And in some respects, that makes me a villain. And while you might think my hate is irresponsible, you might think I'm an idiot for enjoying my own suffering, perhaps the real mistake is rejecting suffering, rejecting the chaos, and therefore rejecting the world as it is. According to Christianity, planet Earth is just one big cosmic accidental pregnancy that needs to be terminated. And I suppose the irony of the Antichrist Superstar is that he falls into that same trap. At the beginning, he says, I have abortions in my eyes. And at the end, he says, spread me open, sticking to my pointy ribs are all your infants and abortion cribs. Basically, he's saying that all of the hate and toxicity of other people turned him into a hateful and toxic person. The Antichrist, therefore, is essentially no different from any of his enemies. And nor is he different from his chief rival and ultimate conqueror, Jesus Christ. The Antichrist and the true Christ are two sides of the same coin because they fill two parts of the same cosmic plan, that great world-ending and world-rejuvenating mission, that great life and death struggle that really makes life what it is. The hypocrisy of the Christ and the Antichrist being one and the same is summed up very eloquently in this delicious oxymoron at the beginning of Irresponsible Hate Anthem, where he gets his legion of adoring fans to chant, "We hate love, we love hate." What is on the surface seemingly just purely subversive and edgy remark really contains within it a lot of wry irony and satire. And it points out the fact that both virtue and corruption are fundamentally imperfect. The one cannot exist without the other. Even in subverting the establishment, the Antichrist took on the appearance, the guise of the establishment, emulating fascist dictators and televangelists who he hated, sort of like how the second beast in Revelation disguised himself as a lamb even though he was speaking the words of the dragon. You can hate the world and still love it in that you want what's best for it. The Antichrist only realizes himself as the disintegrator after he has tried and failed to save the world from its own ignorance. For you can't actually save the people from their ignorance. And yet, It is so hard to resist the urge to try. And if nothing else, in attempting to save the world from its own ignorance, you can save yourself from your own ignorance. And in attempting to be the world's Messiah, you can become your own Messiah. You can create your own salvation, and that's what really matters. It doesn't matter what other people think of you or what your God thinks of you. What matters is what you think of you. If you waste your whole life worrying about what other people think of you, you will stay a worm for the rest of your life. But, on the other hand, there's a balance to it. Because if you go too far in the other direction, the direction of power and influence, you will lose your humanity, just as the Antichrist did. And thus we get, when all of your wishes are granted, many of your dreams will be destroyed. It's all about finding that balance, and Antichrist Superstar reminds us of that by showing what it's like when we alternate between the two extremes of despair and cold hard power. So, even though Antichrist really only represents the satanic half of the dialectic between light and dark, there's also in it that implied light half. And you can see it if you read into the subtext. He isn't rejecting the good because he is evil. He is rejecting the good because the good is evil. Because good and evil are not alternatives to each other. They are both necessary components of life. With every action comes an equal and opposite reaction. And that's what gives life its purpose and its character. Without its opposite, every good action would be meaningless. Thus, the true message of Antichrist Superstar isn't that you should view your life through a prism of hate and suffering, but rather that even though hate and suffering might be unpleasant, they are also what gives life its potency and its charge. That we should cherish fortune and misfortune in tandem with each other, and carry out our will to power in balance and harmony with our true selves, our flawed, stupid, ugly selves.
Like I said before, it's an autobiography of what I see my life as, and I talk about a lot of things that haven't happened yet. And if you want to look at that as a prophecy, you can, but you know, I'm a big believer in the idea of will to power, and if you want something bad enough, you make it happen. And as far as Christianity goes, I mean, Christians are going to see me as the bad guy and as the Antichrist, and that's a role I've accepted. But I see what I do as a positive thing. I'm trying to bring people closer to themselves, you know, that may be further away from God, but that's closer to themselves, and I think that's a good thing. I think that makes people stronger.
Are we immoralists harming virtue? No more than anarchists harm princes. Only because the latter are shot at do they once more sit securely on their thrones. Moral. Morality must be shot at.
Sing with me. Shoot, 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 motherfucker. Shoot, 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 motherfucker.